This audiobook was created using text-to-speech software, and was not read by a real person. Please keep in mind the limitations of the technology when it comes to pacing and pronunciation. Also, if you enjoy the audiobooks we create, please consider supporting the expense of our projects through our Patreon page. Those who do so have access to exclusive book series, are able to download the MP3 files for all books we create, and also have early access to our normal YouTube releases. For more details, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and we hope you enjoy the story. Star Wars: The Courtship of Princess Leia. Written by Dave Wolverton. Preview. Desperate to gain new allies in the fight against the remnants of the Empire, Princess Leia considers a proposal of marriage from the Crown Prince of a powerful star system. But Han Solo is not willing to abandon his love for Leia, and makes a desperate gamble to win her back. Before long, Han, Leia, and Luke find themselves in the middle of a deadly battle between warring clans, on a mysterious planet. Chapter 1. General Han Solo stood at the command console viewport of the Mon Calamari star cruiser, Mon Ramonda. Warning sounds tinkled like wind chimes as the ship prepared to drop out of hyperspace at the New Republic's capital on Coruscant. It had been so long since Han had last seen Leia. 5 months. 5 months hunting the Warlord Zinja's super star destroyer, Iron Fist. 5 months ago, the New Republic had seemed so secure, so in control. Maybe now, with the Iron Fist gone, Warlord Zinj would be crippled, and things would go smoother. Han longed to get off the humid Calamarian ship. Longed even more for the taste of Leia's kisses, the caress of her hand on his brow. He'd seen too much darkness lately. The white starfield on the screen resolved as the hyperdrive engines cut, and Chewbacca roared in alarm. Across the blue velvet of space, where the city night lights of Coruscant blazed from a dark world, were dozens of enormous, saucer-shaped starships that Han recognized immediately as Haepen battle dragons. Among them were dozens of slate-gray Imperial Star Destroyers. "Get us out of here!" Han shouted. He'd seen a Haepen battle dragon only once before, but it had been enough. Full shields. Evasive action. He watched the three dorsal ion guns of the nearest dragon, expecting them to knock him from the sky. The blaster turrets on the saucer's rim all swiveled toward him. The Mon Ramonda twisted and dove planetward, toward the lights of Coruscant. Han's stomach wrenched. His Mon Calamari pilot was well schooled, and knowing that they could not run before setting a new course, he surged into the thick of the Haepen warships so that they could not fire without the risk of hitting one another. Like all the technology on the Mon Calamari ship, the viewport was exceptional, a work of art, so that as they hurtled past the command port of a Haepen battle dragon, Han could make out the startled faces of three Haepen officers, the silver name tags sewn into their collars. Han had never seen a Haepen. Their star sector was renowned for its wealth, and the Haepens guarded their borders jealously. He'd known that they were human, for humans had scattered like weeds across the galaxy, but he was surprised to discover that without exception, all three of the female officers were astonishingly beautiful, like fragile, living ornaments. "Cease evasive action," shouted Captain Onoma, a salmon-colored Calamarian officer, who sat at a control console, monitoring sensors. "What?" Han shouted, surprised that the lower-ranked Calamarian would reverse his orders. "The Haepens are not firing, and they are broadcasting as friendlies," Onoma answered, swiveling a large golden eye at Han. The Calamarian cruiser ceased its crazy headlong dive and slowed. "Friendlies?" Han asked. "They're Haepens. Haepens are never friendly. Nevertheless, they've apparently come to negotiate a treaty of some sort with the New Republic. The accompanying Star Destroyers are theirs, captured from the Imperials. As you can see, our planetary defense forces are still intact. Captain Onoma nodded up toward a star destroyer in another quadrant, and Han recognized its markings. Leia's flagship, the Rebel Dream. It had seemed so huge, so vast when they'd captured it from the Imperials, but here beside this Haven fleet, it looked small, insignificant. Huddled around the Rebel Dream, he saw a dozen smaller Republic dreadnoughts, their hulls still painted with the markings of the old Rebel Alliance. The first time Han had seen a Haven warship, he had been smuggling guns with a small convoy fleet, under the command of Captain Rula. Since the Hapens hadn't yet fallen to the Empire, the smugglers had been using an outpost in neutral territory near the borders of the Haven Star Cluster, hoping that their proximity to the Hapens would keep the Empire off their back. But one day they came out of hyperspace and found a Haven battle dragon hovering in their path. Even though they were in neutral territory, even though they made no aggressive moves, only 3 of the 20 smuggler ships managed to survive the Haven attack. A communications officer said, "General Solo, we're receiving a call from Ambassador Leia Organa." "I'll go to my quarters and pick it up there," Han said, and he hurried to punch up the call. Leia's image appeared on the small screen. Leia was smiling, euphoric, and her dark eyes had a dreamy look to them. "Oh, Han," she said in a breath, her voice mellifluous. "I'm so glad you're here." She wore the pure white uniform of an Alderaanian ambassador, and her hair was down. In the past months it had grown longer than Han had ever seen it. In her hair she wore the combs he had given her, made from silver and opal mined on Alderaan, before Grand Moff Tarkin blasted the planet to cinders with the first Death Star. "I missed you, too," Han said huskily. "Come down to Coruscant, to the Grand Reception Hall," Leia said. "The Haven ambassadors are about to arrive." "What do they want?" "It's not what they want, it's what they're offering. I went to Hapes and spoke with the Queen Mother 3 months ago," Leia said. "I asked her for aid in our fight against Warlord Zinj. She seemed very distant, noncommittal, but promised to think about it. I can only guess they've come to give that aid." Lately, Han had begun to realize that the war against the remnants of the Empire might take years, even decades to win. Zinj and some lesser warlords were firmly entrenched in over a third of the galaxy, but the warlords now seemed to be on the move, pillaging entire star systems as they swept toward the free worlds. The New Republic could not patrol such a vast front. Just as the old Empire had struggled to repel the Rebel Alliance, the New Republic battled the might of the warlords and their vast fleets. Han didn't want Leia to get her hopes raised for a Haven alliance. He said, "Don't expect too much from the Hapens. I've never heard of them giving anyone anything, except a hard time. You don't even know them." "Just come to the Grand Reception Hall," Leia said, suddenly all business. "Oh, and welcome back." She turned away. The transmission ended. "Yeah," Han whispered. "I missed you too." Han and Chewbacca hurried through the streets, toward the Grand Reception Hall on Coruscant. They were in an ancient part of Coruscant, where the planet-wide city had not built over the top of ruins, so that all around them plasteel buildings rose up like the walls of a canyon. The shadows thrown by the steep buildings were so deep that overhead the shuttles streaming through the spaces between buildings were forced to keep their running lights on even in the daytime, creating a massive tapestry of light. By the time Han and Chewie reached the Grand Reception Hall, the processional band was already playing an oddly mincing marching song, using janglers and deep woot horns. The Grand Reception Hall was an enormous building, more than 1,000 meters long, with 14 levels for seating. But as Han neared the entrance, he found that all of the portals were jammed with curious onlookers, eager to see the Hapens. Han ran past the first 5 entrances, then suddenly saw a golden protocol droid nervously trying to jump or stand on tiptoe to see over the crowd. Many people claimed that all droids of a certain model looked alike, but Han recognized C-3PO instantly. No other protocol unit ever managed to look quite as nervous or excited. "3PO, you hunk of tin!" Han shouted, to be heard over the crowd. Chewbacca roared in greeting. General Solo. 3PO responded, a note of relief in his voice. Princess Leia asked that I find you and escort you to the Alderaanian ambassador's balcony. I was afraid I'd missed you in the crowd. You're fortunate that I had the foresight to wait for you here. This way, sir, this way. 3PO led them back across a broad street and up a side ramp, past several guards. As they climbed a long winding corridor, passing door after door, Chewbacca sniffed the air and growled. They rounded the corner and 3PO halted by a balcony entrance. Within, only a few people stood looking through the glass onto the procession below. Han recognized some of them. Carlist Ryken, the Alderaanian general who had commanded Hoth base. Threkken Horm, president of the powerful Alderaanian council, an immensely fat man who rested in a repulsor chair rather than try to carry his own weight. And Mon Mothma, commander of the New Republic, stood next to a bearded gray Godel, who gazed dispassionately toward the main floor, head tilted, aiming his censor horns in Leia's direction. The diplomats were all speaking softly, listening to comlinks and watching Leia, who sat on a dais, regally gazing on a Hapen diplomatic shuttle that had landed on a pad built within the great open-air hall. Perhaps 500,000 beings had gathered on the main floors, eager to catch a glimpse of the Hapens. Tens of thousands of security guards had cleared the gold carpet between the shuttle and Leia, and Han looked up to the balconies. Nearly every star system in the old empire had had its own balcony here, and beside each balcony was the nation's standard. Over 600,000 of those standards hung now on the ancient marble walls, showing the membership of the New Republic. Down on the floor, silence fell as the shuttle dropped its loading ramps. Han went to Mon Mothma. "What's going on?" he asked. "Why aren't you down on the dais with Leia?" "I was not invited to meet the Hapen ambassadors," Mon Mothma replied. "They asked only to see Leia." Since even the Old Republic had very limited contact with Hapen's monarchs over the past 3,000 years, I felt it best to remain aloof until invited. "That's very considerate," Han said, "but you are the elected leader of the New Republic. And Queen Mother, Tae Chum, feels threatened by our democratic ways." "No, I think it best that Tae Chum's ambassadors speak through Leia, if she makes them feel more comfortable. Have you counted the number of battle dragons in the Hapen fleet?" "There are 63, one for each inhabited planet in the Hapes cluster. Never have the Hapens initiated contact with us on such a grand scale. I suspect that this is to be the most important contact our peoples have made in the past 3 millennia. Han would not say it, but he felt slighted at not being seated by Leia's side. The fact that Mon Mothma had been similarly treated added to the offense. They waited only a moment before the Hapens began to disembark. First from the shuttle came a woman with long dark hair and onyx eyes that glittered in the lights. She wore a light dress of peach-colored shimmering material that left her long legs exposed. Microphones on the floor fed into the balcony, and Han could hear a sigh pass through the crowd as the beautiful woman made her way up the promenade. She approached Leia and dropped gracefully to one knee, keeping her eyes on Leia. In a strong voice she spoke in Hapen, "Elin Celebeth e Tae Chum. Shakal Leia, Ireneseth Aapel Serenal Hapes. Renathel Sarun." She turned and clapped her hands 6 times, and dozens of women in shimmering gold dresses began descending from the shuttle, running quickly and playing silver flutes or drums, while others sang over and over in clear high voices, "Hapes, Hapes, Hapes." Mon Mothma listened intently to her comlink as a translator broadcast the words in basic, but Han couldn't hear the translator. "Do you speak this stuff?" Han asked 3PO. "I am fluent in over 6 million forms of communication, sir," 3PO said regretfully, "but I think I must be experiencing a malfunction. The Hapen ambassador cannot have said what I heard." He turned and started to walk off. "Darn these rusty logic circuits. Excuse me while I report for repairs."
"Wait,"
Han said.
"Forget about the repairs. What did she say?"
"Sir, I think I must have misunderstood," 3PO said.
"Tell me." Han added more forcefully, and Chewbacca growled a warning. Well, if you're going to be that way about it. 3PO affected a hurt tone. If my sensors monitored her correctly, the delegate reported the words of the Great Queen Mother, worthy Leia, I offer gifts from the 63 worlds of Hapes. Take joy in them.
Gifts?
Han said. That sounds pretty straightforward to me.
Indeed it is.
The Hapens never ask a favor without offering a gift of equal value first, 3PO said condescendingly.
No, what troubles me is the use of the word, Shakal.
Worthy. The Queen Mother would never apply that word to Leia, for the Hapens use it only when speaking to equals.
Well, Han hazarded a guess, they are both royalty.
True, 3PO said, but the Hapens practically worship their Queen Mother.
Indeed, one of their names for her is, Aranita.
She who has no equal.
So you see, it would not be logical for the Queen Mother to refer to Leia as her equal.
Han looked back down to the unloading ramp and shivered as a sense of foreboding washed through him.
The sounds of drums thundered.
Three women in bright, almost garish silks rushed from the shuttle bearing a large container the color of mother of pearl. 3PO still spoke to himself, shaking his head and saying, I really must have these logic circuits repaired, as the three women spilled the contents onto the floor.
The whole crowd gasped.
Rainbow gems from Galanor. The gems glittered with their own fire in dozens of shades from brilliant cardinal to blazing emerald.
Indeed, the invaluable gems were not gems at all, but a silicon-based life form that glowed with its own brilliant inner light.
The creatures, often worn on medallions, matured only after thousands of years.
One gem could buy a Calamarian cruiser, yet the Hapens had thrown hundreds of mated pairs to the floor.
Leia showed no surprise.
A second trio of women, far taller than the others, descended from the diplomatic shuttle wearing leathers in colors of tawny ochre and cinnamon.
They danced lightly to the sounds of the flutes and drums, and between them floated a platform that bore a small, gnarled tree with ruddy brown fruits.
Twin lights floated above it, beaming steadily like the suns of some desert world.
The crowd murmured quietly until the ambassador explained, Salaba, Tarafel and Lazarla.
From Salab, a tree of wisdom, bearing fruits.
The crowd suddenly shouted and cheered in delight, and Han stood dumbfounded.
He had thought the wisdom trees of Salab to be only a legend.
It was said that the fruit of the wisdom trees could greatly boost the intelligence of those who had passed into old age.
Han's blood pounded in his veins, and he felt lightheaded.
A man came forward to the sound of the music, a cyborg warrior dressed in full Hapen body armor, black with silver trim.
He stood nearly as tall as Chewbacca, and strode purposely, pulled some sort of mechanical device from his arm, and laid it on the ground before Leia.
Chiruba Endara, Mela and Sesselter.
From the high-tech world Chiruba, we offer a gun of command.
Han leaned against the glass for support.
The gun of command had made the Hapen troops nearly irresistible in small arms combat, for it released an electromagnetic wave field that virtually neutralized an enemy's voluntary thought processes.
Those shot with the gun of command stood helpless as invalids, unaware of their surroundings, and tended to follow any orders given them, for they could not distinguish the command of an enemy from their own voluntary thoughts.
Han began sweating.
Their every world, each planet in the Hapi system, is offering its greatest treasures, Han realized.
What could they hope to gain?
What could they want in return?
He watched over the next hour.
The music of the drums and flutes and the high, clear calls of the women singing, Hapes, 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 over and over again, seemed to pound through his veins, through his temples.
12 of the poorer worlds each gave Leia star destroyers captured from the Empire, while others brought things that held more esoteric value.
From Arabanth came an old woman who spoke only a few words, on the importance of embracing life while accepting death, offering a thought puzzle that her people held to be of great value.
The planet Ut sent a woman who sang a song so beautiful that the sound seemed to carry Han away to her world on a warm breeze.
At one point, Han heard Mon Mothma whisper,
I knew Leia had asked for money to help fight the warlords, but I never imagined. And finally, the singers stopped singing and the drums stopped beating and a portion of the wealth of the hidden worlds of Hapes lay scattered on the floor of the grand reception hall. Han found that his breathing came ragged from his lungs, for he kept unconsciously holding his breath as the gifts were offered. The silence on the floor of the hall seemed heavy, ominous. More than 200 ambassadors from the worlds of Hapes stood on the promenade, and Han marveled at them, for once again he was impressed by their grace, by their beauty, by their strength. Until today, he had never seen a Hapen. Now he would never forget them. No one spoke as the Hapens held their silence. Han waited to hear what they would ask in return. His blood thrilled, for he realized they could only want one thing, a pact with the Republic. The Hapens would ask the Republic to join an all-out war against the combined might of warlords who served as the last remnants of the Empire. Leia leaned forward from her throne, looked over the gifts approvingly. You said that you had gifts from all 63 of your worlds, Leia told the ambassador, but I see here gifts from only 62. You have offered me nothing from Hapes itself. Han was shocked by the remark. He had lost count of the gifts long ago, stunned by the wealth the Hapens offered, and now Leia's comments seemed churlish, greedy. He expected the Hapens to scoff at her bad manners, take everything, and leave. Instead, the Hapen ambassador smiled warmly, as if pleased that Leia had noticed, and looked up and held Leia's eyes. She spoke, and 3PO translated, "That is because we have saved our greatest gift for last." She motioned with her hand, and all the Hapen ambassadors stepped aside, clearing the aisle. Without fanfare, without the music of horns, only in silence did they bring their last gift. Two women, modestly dressed in black with silver ringlets in their dark hair, came from the ship. A man walked between them. He wore a silver circlet that held a black veil in front of his face, and his long, blonde hair fell down around his shoulders. The man was bare-chested except for a small silk half-cloak fastened with silver clasps, and in his muscular arms he carried a large, ornate box of ebony inlaid with silver. He brought the box and set it on the floor. He sat on his haunches, hands resting lightly on his knees, and the women pulled back his black veil. Beneath it was the most incredibly handsome man that Han had ever seen. His deep-set eyes were a dark blue-gray, like the color of the sea on the horizon, and promised wit, humor, wisdom. His powerful shoulders and firm jawline were strong. Han realized that this must be some high dignitary from the royal house of Hapes itself. The ambassador spoke, "Hapesa, Rurasantaye Chum, Alessa Isoldir Chumda. From Hapes, the Queen Mother offers her greatest treasure, her son Isoldir, the Chumda, whose wife shall reign as queen." Chewbacca growled and in the crowd below everyone seemed to talk at once, an uproar that swelled in Han's ears like the sound of a storm. Mon Mothma pulled off her headset and gazed at Leia thoughtfully, one of the generals in the room swore and grinned, and Han stepped away from the window. "What?" Han asked. "What does that mean?" "Tae Chum wants Leia to marry her son," Mon Mothma answered softly. "But, she won't do it, will she?" Han said, and then his certainty faltered. 63 of the wealthiest planets in the galaxy. To rule as matriarch over billions of people, with that man beside her. Mon Mothma looked up into Han's eyes, as if gauging him. With the wealth of Hapes to help fund the war, Leia could overthrow the last remnants of the Empire quickly, saving billions of lives in the process. "I know how you have felt about her in the past, General Solo. Still, I think I speak for everyone in the New Republic when I say that, for all our sakes, I hope she accepts the offer." Chapter 2. Luke could sense the ruins of the ancient Jedi Master's home, before his whipped guide brought him to the place. Like the landscape of Tula itself, a barren plain where the short purple lichens thrust up from patches of thin winter ice, the ruins felt clean and refreshing, yet empty. Almost as if they had never been visited by humans. The clean feeling assured Luke that the ruins had once been inhabited by a good Jedi.
The huge whippet, its ivory fur ruffling under the spring winds, trudged over the purple moss, a vibroaxe fitted in its paw. It stopped and raised its long snout in the air so that its massive tusks pointed up at a distant purple sun, then gave a trumpeting whistle, glaring ahead with small black eyes. Luke pulled back the hood of his snowsuit and glimpsed the danger on the horizon. A flock of snow demons was dropping from the shelter of storm clouds, hairy wings flashing gray in the slanting sunlight. The whippet whistled a battle cry, afraid they would attack, but Luke reached out with his mind and felt the snow demons' hunger. They were hunting a herd of shaggy motmots that moved like icy hills on the horizon, seeking a calf small enough to slaughter. "Peace," Luke said, reaching up to touch the whippet's elbow. "Show me the ruins." Luke tried to use the force to calm the warrior. But the whippet quivered, clenching its vibroaxe, eager for battle. The whippet whistled a long reply, pointing north, and Luke translated by power of the force, "Search the Jedi's tomb if you must, little one, but I go to hunt. Having sighted an enemy, honor demands that I attack. My clan will feast on a snow demon tonight." The whippet wore a weapon belt as its only article of clothing, and from the array hanging there, it pulled free a blackened iron morning star. With a weapon in each huge fist, it charged over the tundra faster than Luke would have believed possible. Luke shook his head, pitying the snow demons. R2 whistled from behind, asking Luke to slow his pace as the little droid negotiated a treacherous patch of ice. Together, Luke and R2 traveled north until they reached three huge flat rocks that rose from the ground to form the roof and sides of a tunnel. The tunnel smelled dry, and Luke pulled a mini lantern from his utility belt and made his way down. A short distance from the surface, the tunnel had been caved in. A huge boulder blocked the path. Black soot on the boulder showed where a thermal detonator had blown the stone free in ages past, closing off whatever lay beyond. Luke closed his eyes and reached out with his mind until the force channeled through him. He shifted the rock, lifted it free, and held it. "Go ahead, R2," Luke whispered, and the droid rolled forward, whistling in dismay as it passed beneath the floating rock. Luke ducked under the hovering boulder, then let it settle behind him. On the dirt floor immediately behind the rock, Luke found the boot prints of Imperial stormtroopers, still preserved after all these years. Luke studied the prints, wondering if any would have belonged to his father. Darth Vader probably would have had to come. Only he could have killed the Jedi Master who had lived in these caverns. But the footprints told him nothing. The tunnels wound down through storage rooms carved deep beneath the ground. The air carried the stale scent of rodent dung and fur. A small, square power droid lay dead in one hallway, long since drained of energy. A thermal heater filled another room, its power cables chewed away by small animals. Luke followed the tunnels toward the clean feeling of the Jedi, and finally found the dead master's room. The body was gone, dissipated as Yoda's and Ben's had, but Luke could feel the residue of the master's force, and he discovered a snowsuit, slashed and burned, with a lightsaber nearby. Luke picked up the lightsaber, flipped it on. A stream of opalescent energy shot out as the lightsaber hummed to life. Luke wondered momentarily about the man who had owned the lightsaber, then flipped it off. He knew little except that the Jedi Master had served the Old Republic in its final hours. For months now, Luke had followed the man's trail. As curator of records for the Jedi at Coruscant, the man had seemed only a minor functionary, hardly worthy of notice by the invading Imperials. Yet he had fled Coruscant with the records of 1,000 generations of Jedi. Such records, Luke hoped, would be more than a mere catalogue of the Jedi's deeds. Instead, they might contain the wisdom of the ancient masters, their thoughts, their aspirations. As a young Jedi who had not been thoroughly educated in the ways of the Force, Luke hoped to learn the deeper mysteries of how the Jedi had trained their warriors, their healers, their seers. Luke cast about the room, looking in the feeble light of his mini-lantern for anything that might provide a clue. R2 had gone down a side passage, guiding himself through the dark using his headlamps. From the passage Luke heard a mournful whistle and followed.
It was a hallway that led to blackened rooms carved in the stone where cell after cell of holographic video recordings had been stored. But the recordings were blasted and burned to cinders. Computer cylinders lay in piles of molten slag, their memory cores fried. Thermal detonators had melted the things, but Luke also found chunks from EMP grenades. Whoever had destroyed the hollow vids had done his or her best to erase them first. Luke paced the tunnel, passing dozens upon dozens of cells, gazing into each cell in turn, and his heart went from him. Nothing was left. All of it gone. The knowledge and deeds of 1,000 generations of Jedi. "It's no use, R2," Luke said, and his words seemed to be swallowed by the darkness. The silence of the empty tunnels. R2 whistled sadly, rolled on down the corridor, lifting up on his wheels to peek over the lip of each cell. Gone. All of it gone, Luke realized. The Emperor had not been content to hunt down and murder the Jedi. He had felt the need, in his bid to gain absolute control of the galaxy, not only to extinguish their fire from the universe but to crush their embers, scatter their ashes, so that the Jedi would never rise again. So that after months of searching, Luke found only ashes. Luke sat on the floor, put a hand over his eyes, wondering what his next move should be. Certainly there had been other records, other copies. He would need to go back to Coruscant and begin the search there. From down the hall, near the end of the tunnel, R2 began to whistle excitedly. "Found something?" Luke asked, and he got up, dusted cinders from his clothing, forced himself to walk slowly. R2 had found a cell where the records were not melted. A thermal detonator still lay atop them, an obvious dud. The EMP grenade had fragmented, but Luke wondered how effective it had been. He took a computer cylinder from the top, plugged it into R2. The droid whistled and bent forward, preparing to display the hologram, but after a moment ejected the cube with a grinding wheeze. "Come on," Luke whispered hopefully. Reaching near the bottom of the pile, Luke freed a second cylinder, popped it into the droid, and R2 flashed the image of a man dressed in flowing, pale green robes. Yet static interfered so that the hollow image soon broke up. R2 spat out the cylinder, and light from his headlamp shone once again into the cell, urging Luke to try again. "Okay," Luke sighed, and he searched for a cylinder farthest from the EMP grenade. He dug through the pile, found one in a far corner on the floor, and was about to pull it free when he felt the force tug him in another direction. He fumbled among the cylinders, until his fingers brushed one. Very distinctly, he felt a sense of peace. This one," a voice seemed to whisper. "This is what you seek." Luke grasped it, pulled it free, and stepped away. Somehow, he knew that to search the caverns further would be useless. If any answers were to be found here, they were in his hand. He popped the cylinder into R2, and almost immediately R2 caught a signal. Images flashed in the air before the droid, an ancient throne room where, one by one, Jedi came before their High Master to give reports. Yet, the hollow was fragmented, so thoroughly erased that Luke got only bits and pieces. A blue-skinned man describing details of a grueling space battle against pirateers. A yellow-eyed Twi'lek with lashing head tails, who told of discovering a plot to kill an ambassador. A date and time flashed on the hollow vid before each report. The report was nearly 400 standard years old. Then Yoda appeared on the video, gazing up at the throne. His color was more vibrantly green than Luke remembered, and he did not use his walking stick. At middle age, Yoda had looked almost perky, carefree. Not the bent, troubled old Jedi Luke had known. Most of the audio was erased, but through the background hiss, Yoda clearly said, "We tried to free the Chuun Thor from Dathomir, but were repulsed by the witches. Skirmish, with Masters Grahatun and Vulatan. 14 acolytes killed, go back to retrieve." The audio hissed away, and soon the hollow image dissolved to blue static with popping lights. Other people gave reports, but none of their words seemed to offer hope. Again and again, Luke reflected on the words, "Chuun Thor, from Dathomir."
Was the Chuanthor a single person, perhaps a political leader, or could it have been a whole race of beings? And Dathomir? Where was it?
R2, Luke said.
Run through your astrogation files and tell me if you find any reference to a place named Dathomir. It could be a star system, a single planet. Maybe even a person, he thought with dismay.
R2 took a moment, then whistled a negative.
I thought not, Luke said. I've never heard of it, either. During the Clone Wars, so many planets had been destroyed, made uninhabitable. Perhaps Dathomir was one of those, a world so ravaged that it had been forgotten. Or perhaps it was a small place, a moon on some planet on the outer rim, so far from civilization that it had nearly been lost from the records. Maybe even less than a moon, a continent, an island, a city. Whatever the case, Luke felt certain that he would find it, sometime, somewhere. They went up topside, and found that night had fallen while they worked underground. Their whipped guide soon returned, dragging the body of a gutted snow demon. The demon's white talons curled in the air, and its long purple tongue snaked out from between its massive fangs. Luke was amazed that the whipped could haul such a monster, yet the whipped held the demon's long hairy tail in one hand and managed to pull it back to camp. There, Luke stayed the night with the whippeds in a huge shelter made from the rib cage of a motmot, covered over with hides to keep out the wind. The whippeds built a bonfire and roasted the snow demon, and the young danced while the elders played their claw harps. As Luke sat, watching the writhing flames and listening to the twang of harps, he meditated. The future you will see, and the past. Old friends long forgotten. Those were the words Yoda had said long ago while training Luke to peer beyond the mists of time. Luke looked up at the rib bones of the motmot. The whippeds had carved stick letters into the bone, 10 and 12 meters in the air, giving the lineage of their ancestors. Luke could not read the letters, but they seemed to dance in the firelight, as if they were sticks and stones falling from the sky. The rib bones curved toward him, and Luke followed the curve of bones with his eyes. The tumbling sticks and boulders seemed to gyrate, all of them falling toward him as if they would crush him. He could see boulders hurtling through the air, too, smashing toward him. Luke's nostrils flared, and even Tula's chill could not keep a thin film of perspiration from dotting his forehead. A vision came to Luke then. Luke stood in a mountain fortress of stone, looking over a plain with a sea of dark forested hills beyond, and a storm rose, a magnificent wind that brought with it towering walls of black clouds and dust, trees hurtling toward him and twisting through the sky. The clouds thundered overhead, filled with purple flames, obliterating all sunlight, and Luke could feel a malevolence hidden in those clouds and knew that they had been raised through the power of the dark side of the Force. Dust and stones whistled through the air like autumn leaves. Luke tried to hold on to the stone parapet overlooking the plain to keep from being swept from the fortress walls. Winds pounded in his ears like the roar of an ocean, howling. It was as if a storm of pure dark force raged over the countryside, and suddenly, amid the towering clouds of darkness that thundered toward him, Luke could hear laughing. The sweet sound of women laughing. He looked above into the dark clouds, and saw the women borne through the air, along with the rocks and debris, like motes of dust, laughing. A voice seemed to whisper. The witches of Dathomir.
Chapter 3.
Leia unplugged the comlink from her ear, and gazed at the Hapen ambassador in shock. Hapens were hard to deal with, so culturally distant, easily offended. The roar of the hundreds of thousands in the crowd began to swell, and Leia looked up to the windows of the Alderaanian balcony, wondering what to answer. Han had turned away and was speaking excitedly to Mon Mothma. Above the uproar, Leia said to the ambassador, "Tell Tae Chum that her gifts are exquisite, her generosity unbounded. Still, I need time to consider the offer." She paused, wondering how long she could legitimately take. The Hapens were a decisive people. Tae Chum had a reputation for making decisions of monumental importance in the space of hours. Could Leia take a day? She felt dizzy, almost giddy. "Please, may I speak? Prince Isildur asked in accented Basic, and Leia halted, surprised that Isildur could speak her language at all. She looked into his grey eyes, remembering the warm thunderheads over the tropical mountains of Hapes. Isildur smiled apologetically. There was a certain strength to his face, a ringiness. I know your customs differ from ours. Among the ancients, this is how we arranged our royal marriages. But I want you to feel comfortable with any decision. Please, take time to get to know Hapes, our worlds, our customs, take time to know me. Something in the way he spoke made Leia realize that this was an unusual offer. 30 days, she asked. I would take less time, but I must leave for the Roche system in a couple of days. A diplomatic mission. Prince Isildur lowered his eyes in acceptance. Of course. A queen must forever be at the call of her people. Then he added apologetically, if you are leaving on a diplomatic mission, will I have time to meet with you previous to it, under less formal circumstances? Leia considered furiously. She had a great deal of studying to do before she left, trade agreements, registered complaints, studies in exobiology. The Verpines, an insect race, had apparently broken dozens of contracts to build warships for the carnivorous Barabels, and it was very unhealthy to break a contract with a Barabel. Meanwhile, the Verpines claimed the ships had been taken by one of their mad hive mothers and felt no obligation to force the hive mother to return the merchandise. The whole affair was complicated by substantiated rumors that the Barabels had begun negotiating to sell Verpine body parts to chefs among the insect-loving Kabazis. Leia simply felt that she had no business letting her personal life interfere with her work, at least not now. Leia glanced up at the observation deck. Han had left with Chewbacca, and now Mon Mothma stood, holding the comlink to her ear. Mon Mothma did not move, but beside her sat Threkken Horm, president of the Alderaanian Council. Threkken nodded the affirmative, urging Leia on. Yes, of course, Leia said. If you are free to join me before the mission. My days and nights are yours, the prince said, smiling gently. Then please, Leia asked, join me for dinner tonight, in my stateroom aboard the Rebel Dream? Isildur lowered his eyes again, used the thumbs and index fingers of both hands to pull the black veil over his face. Leia had marveled at the beauty of the Hapens during her visit, but now felt a twinge of regret that Isildur hid his face, felt guilty for wanting to gaze at him longer. Leia left the grand reception hall, thousands watching her departure. Leia felt anxious, and only wanted to find Han. She went to her quarters at the embassy, hoping Han would be there, but the apartments were empty. Perplexed, she used her comlink on the military frequency, and found he had left Coruscant on his way to the Rebel Dream. That was a bad sign. The Millennium Falcon had been docked aboard the Rebel Dream, awaiting Han's return. When Han felt worried or frustrated, he liked to work on the Falcon. Working with his hands, solving familiar problems, seemed to ease his mind. So he had run to his ship, to work. This proposal must have disturbed him deeply, probably more deeply than even Han knew. Leia was bone-weary, but she could see why Han would be in a bad mood. She summoned her personal shuttle. She found the Falcon at docking Bay 90. Han and Chewie were in the main cabin at the control panels, worrying over the tangled mass of wires that connected to various projectile and energy shields. Chewie looked up and roared in greeting, but Han sat holding a plasma torch, facing away. He switched off the torch, but did not shift in the captain's chair to look at her. Hi, Leia said softly. I was hoping to find you back in my room on Coruscant. Yeah, well, there were some things I needed to check into, Han said. Leia didn't answer for a long moment. Chewbacca got up and hugged Leia, pressing the fur of his tawny belly into her face, then went down below, leaving them alone. Han turned to face her. His forehead was sweaty, though she knew he couldn't have been working long enough to perspire. So, how did it go down there? What did you tell the Hapens? I asked them to give me a few days to think, Leia answered.
She didn't feel ready to tell him that Isoldir would be visiting aboard the Rebel Dream that night.
Han nodded. Leia took his grimy hands in hers. She said softly, "I couldn't just send them away, it would be rude. Even if I don't want to marry their prince, I can't destroy our chance to build a relationship with them. The Hapens are very powerful. The whole reason I went to Hapes was to see if they would aid in our fight against the warlords."
"I know," Han sighed. "You would do just about anything to win against them.
Now what is that supposed to mean?
You hated the Empire, but now Zinj and the warlords are all that is left of it. You've risked your life fighting them a dozen times. You would give your life for the New Republic in a moment, wouldn't you, without thinking, without regrets?"
"Of course," Leia answered.
"But..."
"Then I suspect you'll give your life now," Han said, "give it to the Hapens. But instead of dying for them, you'll live for them."
I couldn't do that," Leia assured him.
Han stared at her, breathing hard, and all the pain and accusation went out of his voice.
"Of course not," Han sighed, setting the torch down on the floorboard.
"I don't know what I was thinking. I just..."
Leia stroked his forehead. After 5 months away from him, she felt a little clumsy. Normally, she imagined, he would take something like the Hapen proposal as a joke, but he was quiet. Something more was going on. Something was hurting him very deeply.
"What's wrong?
You aren't acting like yourself."
"I don't know," Han whispered.
"It's just, this last mission. Coming back to this. I'm so tired. You saw what the Iron Fist did on Salagis. It turned the whole colony into rubble. I kept following it for months, and everywhere we went it was the same, star stations obliterated, shipyards ruined. Just one super star destroyer with a murderer at the helm. Back when the Emperor died, I thought we'd won. But I keep finding that we're fighting something so huge, so monstrous. Every time we blink, another Grand Moff announces another lofty unification scheme, or some ragtag sector general rears his or her ugly head. I have dreams at night that I'm fighting this beast in the fog, this huge beast that's roaring and devouring. I can't see its body, but its head comes out of the mist, eyes flaming, and I battle it with an axe, and I finally strike off the head. Then within moments I hear roaring in the fog as the beast grows a new head. I can't see where it's coming from, I can't see the body. I know it's out there, but it's all invisible. We've lost so much, and we're still losing.
The war,"
Leia said. "It must feel that way, out on the front lines," she soothed him. "The warlords, like the empire they served, thrive on fear and greed. But as a diplomat, almost all I see are victories. Every day another world joins the New Republic. Every day we make some small inroads. We may be losing some battles, but we're winning the war. What if the Empire were perfecting the cloaking devices for their star destroyers?"
Han asked.
"We keep hearing rumors. Or what if Zinj or some other Grand Moff just builds another ship like the Iron Fist, or a fleet of them?"
Leia swallowed.
"Then we'd keep fighting. It takes so much energy to run a super star destroyer of that size, Zinj could not afford to run more than one or two at a time. The expenses are too high. Eventually, we would wear him down."
"This war isn't over," Han said.
"It might not end during our lifetimes." She had never seen Han like this, looking so drained. "If we can't win peace for ourselves, then we'll fight for our children," Leia answered. Han leaned back, rested his head against Leia's breast, and she knew what he was thinking. She had said our children. Han would be thinking about the Hapens. "I have to admit," Han said, "the Hapens sure made a tempting offer today. You hear rumors about the riches of the hidden worlds, but wow. Did you get to see much of Hapes when you were there?"
"Yes," Leia answered firmly.
"You should see what the Queen Mothers have built over the centuries. Their cities are beautiful, stately, serene. But it's not just the homes or factories, it's their people, their ideals. It feels like,
peace. Han looked up into her dreamy eyes. You're in love.
No, I'm not, Leia said.
But Han twisted around, grabbed her shoulders.
Yes, you are.
He looked into her eyes.
Listen, sweetheart, you may not be in love with Isildur, but you're in love with his world.
When the Emperor destroyed Alderaan, he destroyed everything you loved, everything you were fighting for.
You can't put that behind you.
You're homesick. Leia caught her breath, realizing it was true. She had never quit grieving for Alderaan, four friends lost. And there was a certain similarity between the two worlds in the simplicity and grace of the architecture. The people of Alderaan had had such a respect for life that they refused to build their cities in the plains, where the inhabitants would trample the grasses. Instead, their majestic cities rose from the tops of sandstone bluffs among the rolling fields, or were wedged into crevices under polar ice, or stood on gigantic stilts in Alderaan's shallow seas. Leia put her hand over her eyes. The tears started to well up. Those had been simpler times.
Here, here, Han whispered, and he pulled down her hand and kissed it.
There's no need to cry. Everything is such a mess, Leia said, this mission to the Verpines, the battles with the warlords. I've been working so hard, taking on one mission after another. And through it all I keep hoping we'll find a home world, but nothing seems to work.
What about New Alderaan?
Support services found you a nice place. And 5 months ago some of Zinja's agents discovered it. We had to evacuate, at least temporarily.
I'm sure something else will turn up.
Maybe, but even if we find something, it won't be like home, Leia said. We've been holding meetings with the Alderaanian Council every month. We've discussed terraforming one of the worlds from our own system, starting a space station, or buying another world. But most of the refugees from Alderaan are poor traders, or diplomats who were off-planet when the Empire attacked. We don't have the kind of money it takes to buy or terraform. It would impoverish us for generations. Meanwhile, the scouts are looking for some unmapped world on the fringe of the galaxy, but our traders rightfully don't want any part of that. They've already established trade routes on other worlds, and we can't ask them to isolate themselves from their sources of income. We're reaching an impasse, and some of the council members are just giving up.
What about the gifts the Haypens gave you today?
They would go a long way toward making a big down payment on a planet.
You don't know the Haypens.
Their customs are very strict. If I accept their gifts, it's an all-or-nothing deal. Unless I marry Isildur, I have to give it all back.
Then give it back, Han said.
I don't think you want to get involved with the Haypens.
They're a bad lot.
You don't even know them, Leia answered, astonished that he would speak that way about an entire culture that spanned dozens of star systems.
And I suppose you do.
Han countered. Does a week getting brainwashed by their propaganda chiefs on Haypies make you an expert on their civilization?
You're talking about an entire cluster here, Leia said, billions of people.
You've never seen a Haypen before today.
How could you talk about them that way?
The Haypens have kept closed borders for over 3,000 years, Han said.
I've seen firsthand what happens when you get too close to them.
Believe me, they're hiding something.
Hiding something?
They've got nothing to hide. All they have is a peaceful way of life that they feel is threatened by outside influences.
If this Queen Mother is so fantastic, why would she feel threatened by us?
Han asked.
Nah, Princess, she's hiding something.
She's scared.
I can't believe this, Leia said.
How could you even think that?
If things were so terrible in the Haypies cluster, don't you think we'd see defectors, refugees?
Nobody ever leaves.
Maybe it's because they can't get out, Han said.
Maybe those Haypen patrols don't just keep out the troublemakers.
That's absurd, Leia said.
You're paranoid.
Paranoid, huh?
What about you, Princess?
Have a few baubles and trinkets so blinded you that you can't see straight?
Oh, you sound so sure of yourself. Do you really feel so threatened by Isildur?
Threatened?
By that big lout?
Me?
Han pointed at himself.
Of course not.
She knew he was lying. Then you won't mind that I'm having a private dinner with him tonight?
Dinner?
Han asked. Why should I mind that he's dining with the woman I love, the woman who claims to be in love with me?
You're so cute, Leia said sarcastically.
I came here to invite you to dinner, too, but now I think that maybe, just maybe, I should just let you sit up here and gnaw on your own petty jealous fantasies.
Leia stormed from the control room of the Millennium Falcon, and Han shouted at her back,
Well, fine, I'll see you at dinner.
He banged a wall with his fist.
After Leia left, Han threw his heart into working on the Falcon, so that his mind numbed and the sweat poured from his face. He used a few tricks he'd learned, to boost the rear energy deflector shields 14% over their peak efficiency rating, then went under the ship to work on the swivel guns while Chewie stayed inside, pulling out the main focusing lenses for the ventral blasters. 2 hours of hard work later, an entourage entered the docking bay with fat old Threkenhorm in the lead. The president of the Alderaanian Council floated in his repulsor chair as he led Prince Isildur, the prince's bodyguards, and half a dozen curious minor officials around the hangar bay.
This, as you can see, is one of our repair docks, Threkenhorm said in his nasal voice, planting a thumb firmly between his third and fourth chins.
And this is our esteemed General Han Solo, a hero of the New Republic, working on his private, ship, the Millennium Falcon.
Prince Isildur scrutinized the Falcon, gazing at the rusting metal exterior, the odd panoply of components.
Somehow, in all his years running the Falcon, Han had never felt quite so embarrassed by the thing.
It truly did look like a hunk of junk, sitting there on the gleaming black floors of a Star Destroyer.
Isildur stood taller than Han, and his thick chest and arms seemed somehow intimidating, but not as intimidating as his regal manners or the calm strength of his face, the sea-gray eyes, the straight nose, and the thick hair hanging around his shoulders. He wore a different outfit now, another silk half-cape, over a white top that did not conceal the sculpted muscles of his belly or the prince's dark tan.
Isildur looked like some barbaric god, come to life.
Han here is an old friend to Her Highness Princess Leia Organa, Threkenhorm added.
He has, in fact, saved her life a number of times, if I am not mistaken.
Isildur shifted his attention to Han and smiled warmly.
So, you are not only Leia's friend but her savior?
Isildur asked, and in his eyes Han thought he saw true gratitude.
Our people owe you a great debt.
Isildur's strong, soft voice had an odd accent. The long vowels were deeply inflected, as if the prince were afraid he would cut them short.
Oh, I guess you could say I'm more than her savior, Han answered.
We're lovers, to be precise.
General Solo.
Threkken sputtered, but Prince Isildur raised a hand.
That is all right, Isildur said.
She is a lovely woman. I can understand why you would be attracted to her.
I hope my appearance here hasn't been too unsettling.
Annoying is the word, Han answered.
I mean, it's not as if I wished you were dead or anything.
Neutered perhaps, not dead.
I apologize, Prince Isildur.
Threkken stuttered, then shot a venomous glance at Han.
I rather expected more civility from a general in the New Republic.
I thought he would at least know how to behave himself.
Threkken's frown suggested that Han was seriously in jeopardy of losing his rank, if Threkken had any control over it.
Isildur studied Han a moment, then bowed slightly so that his long, sandy blonde locks danced around his shoulders.
He smiled at Han, believe me, no offense is taken.
General Solo is a warrior, and he wishes to do battle for the woman he loves.
That is the warrior's way.
General Solo, would you kindly show me the inside of your ship?
Gladly, Your Highness, Han answered, and he led Isildur up the gangplank.
Threkenhorm sputtered and tried to follow, but two of Isildur's female bodyguards stepped in Horm's path.
One beautiful redhead casually dropped her hand to her blaster, and a silent alarm sounded in Han's head. He'd seen people like her before, people who were confident, people so familiar with their weapons that the blaster seemed almost an extension of their bodies. This woman was dangerous. Threkenhorn must have realized this, too, for he stopped in his tracks. As Han climbed up into the ship, he kept waiting for Isildur to slug him from behind. Instead, the prince simply followed, listened attentively as Han showed off his hyperdrive unit, the sublight engines, and the weaponry and defenses that he'd slowly built up through accretion over the years. When Han had finished, Isildur leaned toward him and asked, seeming bewildered, "Do you mean to say that it actually flies?" "Oh yes," Han said, wondering if the prince was truly astonished or if he were merely impudent. "And she's fast. The fact that you can keep this ship together at all speaks very highly of your skills. This is a smuggler's ship, no? Fast speeds, secret compartments, hidden weaponry." Han shrugged. "I'm familiar with smugglers. I left home when I was young and worked for a few seasons as a profiteer," Isildur said. "Have you seen one of our Hapi's Nova-class battlecruisers?" "No," Han answered, looking at Isildur, feeling curiosity and a sudden sense of respect for the prince. The prince clasped his hands behind his back, said thoughtfully, "They are over 400 meters long, go without refueling for over a year, are very fast, and could blow this ship out of the sky before you had time to cry out." "Are you threatening me?" Han asked. "No," Isildur said, then whispered conspiratorially, "I will give one to you, if you promise to use it to fly far, far away from here." Han leaned forward, whispered back in the same tone, "No deal." Isildur grinned, admiration shining from his eyes. "Good, you are a man of principles. Then let me appeal to those principles. General Solo, what can you really offer Leia?" Han faltered a moment, unprepared to answer. "She loves me and I love her. That's enough. If you love her, then leave her to me," Isildur said. "She wants the security that Hapes offers her people. But loving you would only cramp her, give her a smaller life than she deserves." He began to leave, edging past Han in the small hallway, but Han grabbed the prince by the shoulder and spun him around. "Wait a minute," Han said. "What's going on here? Let's put all our weapons on the table." "What do you mean?" Isildur asked. "I mean there are a lot of princesses in the universe, and I want to know why you're here. Why did your mother choose Leia? She has no wealth, nothing to offer Hapes. If you want a treaty with the New Republic, there are easier ways to get it." Isildur looked down into Han's eyes, and smiled. "I understand that Leia has invited you to dine with us this evening. I think, perhaps, both of you should hear what I have to say." Chapter 4. When Han arrived at Leia's stateroom for dinner, dressed in his finest military blues with all the appropriate bangles, the party was already into its second course. It was obvious that Leia had not expected him. Prince Isildur sat to Leia's left, dressed in a conservative dinner jacket, with his Amazon guards at his back. Han couldn't help staring at the women for a moment. Both of them were dressed in seductive outfits of fiery red silk, with silver-plated blasters sheathed on one hip, and intricately decorated vibroswords on the other. Threkenhorn sat to Leia's right in his repulsor chair, acting as a dinner escort. As the servers hurriedly set a place for Han, Leia introduced him to Isildur. Threkenhorn blurted rather icily, "They've already met." Leia looked at Threkken, whose face was reddening in anger, and Han said, "Yeah, the prince stopped by for a chat while I was working on the Millennium Falcon. We, found that we have some things in common." Han turned away rather quickly as he took his seat, hoping that Leia wouldn't see his embarrassment. "Oh, really, I'd like to hear all about it." Leia's tone hinted at reprisal. "Yes, General Solo, why don't you tell her all about it?" Threkken growled. There was an uncomfortable silence, and Prince Isildur cut in, "Well, for one thing,
I was fascinated to learn that both General Solo and I had once worked as privateers. It really is a small universe.
As privateers? Threcken asked suspiciously. Han released a breath in relief.
Yes, Isoldir said. When I was a boy, still in my teens, privateers attacked the royal flagship and murdered my older brother. That is when I became the Chunda, the heir. I was young, idealistic, so I secretly left home, assumed a new identity. For 2 years I plied the trade lines as a privateer, working on ship after ship, hunting for the pirate who killed my brother.
What an intriguing story, Leia said. Did you ever find him?
Yes, Isoldir said.
I did. His name was Harovan. I arrested him, and we held him in a prison on Hapes.
Working with pirates must have been very dangerous, Threcken interjected.
Why, if they had ever discovered your identity?
The pirates were not so dangerous as one might think, Isoldir said.
The greatest threat came from my mother's naval forces.
We had frequent encounters.
You mean your own mother didn't know where you were?
Leia asked.
No.
The media believed I was hiding in fear, and since my own mother did not know where I had gone, she downplayed my disappearance, hoping I would resurface.
And the pirate that you captured, Harovan, what became of him?
Han asked.
He was murdered in prison while awaiting trial, Isoldir said heavily, before he could ever name his accomplices.
There was an uncomfortable silence for a moment, and Leia looked at Han. She obviously recognized that Isoldir had changed the topic to protect him from her anger.
Han cleared his throat. Do you have a lot of problems with privateers in the Hapes cluster?
Not really, Isoldir said. The interior of the cluster is remarkably secure, but we consistently have problems on the rim, no matter how well we patrol.
Our encounters on the rim are frequent, and frequently bloody.
I survived one of those encounters as a privateer, Han said. After what we went through, I'm amazed that pirates would work your cluster.
Han wondered at Isoldir.
He had worked as a privateer, risking his life against the might of his mother's own navy, risking that the pirates he worked with might discover his identity. Isoldir was handsome and rich, and those traits in themselves made him a threat, but Han began to realize that this foreign prince must have a great deal of grit hidden beneath his smooth exterior. He wasn't the kind of man who needed to hide behind Amazon bodyguards.
Isoldir shrugged.
The Hapes cluster is very rich, and that always attracts interest from outsiders.
But I'm sure you know our history.
Certain young men tend to glorify the old lifestyle.
Your history?
Han asked.
Leia smiled.
Didn't you learn anything at the academy?
I learned how to pilot a fighter ship, Han said.
As for politics, I leave that to the diplomats.
Leia said, the Hapes cluster was originally settled by pirates, a group called the Lorel Raiders.
For hundreds of years they stalked the trade routes of the Old Republic, seizing ships, stealing cargo.
And when they found a beautiful woman, some raider would take her as a prize to the hidden worlds of Hapes.
In short, Han, the raiders were your kind of people.
Han began to protest, but Leia smiled warmly, teasing him.
Threckenhorn said in his high voice, so the women of Hapes raised their children as best they could.
The pirates would steal the boys, making them pirates in turn.
They would leave for months at a time, then come back to rest.
Han looked up.
Threckenhorn was studying Isoldir's bodyguards with as much interest as he usually showed food, and Han suddenly understood why so many of the Hapens were beautiful, they had been bred for it over generations.
Prince Isoldir said, when the Jedi finally wiped out the Lorel raiders, the pirate fleets never returned.
The worlds of Hapes were forgotten for a time, and the women of Hapes took control of their own destiny and vowed that no man would ever rule them again.
For thousands of years now, the Queen Mothers have kept that vow.
And they've done a fine job for their worlds, Leia said.
Still, sadly, a few of our young men feel powerless in our society, Isoldir added.
And so they glorify the old ways.
When they rebel, often they become pirates. Thus we have a perennial problem. Han ate a few bites of dinner, some type of meat that tasted spicy and amphibious, and he realized he had no idea what he was eating.
But we are off the subject, Freckenhorn said. I believe Leia asked only a few minutes ago what you two talked about today.
He glared at Han.
Ah, yes, Prince Isildur said.
Han asked a question that I believe deserves an answer. He wondered, with all the other princesses in the galaxy, including many that are far more wealthy than Leia, why my mother would choose her.
The truth is, the Queen Mother did not choose Leia, Isildur said calmly, gazing at Han.
I chose her. Freckenhorn must have inhaled some food, for he began coughing into his napkin.
Isildur turned to Leia.
When Leia's shuttle landed on Hapes, she met my mother for a soiree in the gardens. They were so surrounded by dignitaries from the worlds of Hapes that Leia did not speak to me, perhaps never even saw me. I do not think she even knew I was alive. But I became enamored of her. I have never done anything like this. I've never been so impulsive. No other woman has captivated me this way. It was not my mother's idea to arrange a marriage with Leia. She only consented to my request.
Isildur took Leia's hand and kissed it.
Leia blushed, simply staring at Prince Isildur.
Han looked at Isildur's grey eyes, at the golden hair cascading down his shoulders and the strong, handsome face, and he could not see how Leia could resist such a man.
Then Han's mind went blank, and the next thing he knew, he was rising from the table, stumbling out of his chair.
All eyes turned to him, and he felt clumsy, stupid, like a little boy.
His tongue felt thick in his mouth, and he sat down.
His mind was in such a turmoil that he said nothing, practically heard nothing through the rest of the dinner.
As they prepared to leave an hour later, Han kissed Leia goodnight, swiftly, and wondered afterward how it had felt to Leia, as if kissing were some athletic event she would judge.
Freckenhorn shook Leia's hand warmly and left first, while Prince Isildur stood and talked quietly with Leia for a moment, thanking her for the dinner, thanking her for the time she had spent with him. He made some small joke, and Leia laughed quietly.
Just as Han realized that Isildur was hesitant to leave Leia, the prince kissed her good night, holding her close.
It started as a friendly kiss, the kind that dignitaries often exchange, but he lingered a second, and then for a second more.
He stepped away, and Leia gazed into his eyes.
Isildur thanked her again for a wonderful night, glanced at Han, and a moment later Han and Isildur were outside her door, Isildur walking off with his bodyguards at his back.
I'm going to fight you for her, Han said to the prince's back.
It was an oafish thing to say, but Han's head was spinning, and he could think of nothing else.
The prince stiffened, turned.
I know, he said. But I promise you, General Solo, I intend to win her.
Much is at stake here.
More than you know.
Long after dinner with Prince Isildur, Leia lay in bed, luxuriating. She nearly fell asleep once, but the whining of the ship's engines as technicians tested the hyperdrive awakened her. On her dresser the rainbow gems of Galanor smoldered in their dull lights, and in a corner, the salab tree gave off an exotic, nutty scent that suffused the room.
Threkken had insisted on storing the treasures in Leia's room, but Leia tried not to dwell on the riches.
Instead, Isildur filled her thoughts, his courtesy to Han during dinner, his attentiveness, his small jokes and easy laughter.
And finally, his profession of love.
In the middle of her normal sleep cycle Leia rose from bed. In an attempt to get her mind off Isildur, she sat down at a computer console and studied the verpines.
The large insects had long been a spacefaring race, and had colonized the Roche asteroid belts before the Old Republic was born.
They had developed an odd form of government.
Because they communicated via radio waves using a strange organ in their chests, a single verpine could talk with the entire race within seconds, allowing the verpines to develop something of a communal mind.
Yet each verpine considered itself completely aloof from the group, not controlled by the hive.
A verpine who made a decision that might be considered wrong by the group was never punished,
never condemned. The acts of the mad hive mother who had sabotaged the Barabel contracts weren't seen as a crime to be rectified, but only as a sickness to be pitied. Leia looked through the files and found ample evidence of Verpine criminals in the history books, murderers, thieves. And she discovered something very interesting. Nearly all of them had one thing in common, a set of damaged antennae. This fact made Leia wonder if the Verpines hadn't developed more of a communal mind than they realized. A Verpine without antennae was forever alone, unreachable. Whatever the reason for the Verpines' behavior, the Barabels were mad enough to slaughter the whole species and chop them into hors d'oeuvres. Leia knew she wouldn't find an answer until she reached the Roche system and met the Verpines. She probably wouldn't understand the whole truth even if she met the Mad Hive Queen herself. Leia rubbed her weary eyes, but was too wound up to sleep. Instead, she walked the long corridors to the hollow vid room and said to the operator, "I would like to arrange a broadcast to Luke Skywalker. You should be able to reach him at the New Republic Embassy on Tula." The operator nodded, made the connection, and spoke with an operator there. "Skywalker is in the wilderness. We can have him at the hollow vid screen within an hour, if it is an emergency."
"Please do," Leia said. "I'll wait for him here. I can't sleep anyway."
She took a seat nearby, then waited for Luke. When he appeared, he stood in a tall building wearing a dark wool greatcoat. Behind him was a huge window of cut glass. A pale red sun shone coldly through the glass, scattering light all around him in a fiery halo.
"What's the emergency?"
Luke asked, breathless. Leia suddenly felt embarrassed, shy. She told him about Isildur, about the treasures piled in her room and the Hapen's proposal. Luke remained calm, studying her face for a moment.
"Isildur frightens you? I can feel your fright."
"Yes," Leia said. "And you feel tenderness for him, something that might even turn into love. But you don't want to hurt either Han or the prince?"
"Yes," Leia said.
"Oh, I'm almost sorry I called you with something so trivial."
"No, this isn't trivial," Luke said, and suddenly his pale blue eyes seemed to look beyond her, focusing on something in the distance.
"Have you ever heard of a planet called Dathomir?"
"No," Leia answered.
"Why?"
"I don't know," Luke said, "just a feeling. I'm coming to you. I sense an urgency. I should reach Coruscant in 4 days.
I'll be to the Roche system in 3.
I'll meet you there, then."
"Good," Leia said. "I'd like you nearby."
"In the meantime," Luke offered, "take things slowly. Find out how you feel. You don't have to decide between the two in a day.
Forget about Isildur's wealth. You wouldn't be marrying his planets, you would be marrying him. Just give him the same consideration you would give to any other man, okay?"
Leia nodded, suddenly becoming conscious of how much this call would cost.
"Thank you," she said. "I'll see you soon."
"I love you," Luke said, and he faded.
Leia went back to her room, lay in bed for a long time before she fell asleep. She was wakened in the early morning by door chimes. She found Han at the door, holding a starburst plant.
"I came to apologize for yesterday," Han said, offering the plant. The brilliant yellow flowers on their dark stalks seemed to twinkle as they opened and closed.
Leia took it, smiled warmly, and Han kissed her.
"How do you think dinner went?" he asked.
"Fine," Leia said. "Isildur was a perfect gentleman."
"Not too perfect, I hope," Han said.
Leia didn't laugh at his joke, and he hurried to add, "After dinner last night, I went to my room and gnawed on my own petty jealous fantasies for a while."
"How did they taste?"
Leia asked.
"Oh, you know. I ended up going to one of the ship's galleys in the middle of the night, looking for something tastier to eat."
Leia laughed, and Han stroked her cheek.
"There's that smile. I love you, you know."
"I know."
"Good," Han said, taking a deep breath.
"So how do you think the dinner went?
You aren't going to give up, are you?"
Leia asked.
Han shrugged.
Well, he seemed nice enough, Leia answered.
I guess.
I plan to invite him to stay here on the ship while we go to the Roche system.
You what?
I'm going to invite him to stay here on the ship.
Why?
Because he's only going to be here for a few weeks, then he'll leave and I'll never see him again.
That's why.
Han began shaking his head.
I hope you didn't fall for that line about how he fell in love with you from a distance, he said a little loudly, and how he begged his mother for the chance to marry you.
Does that bother you?
Of course it bothers me.
Han shouted.
Why shouldn't it bother me?
His gaze turned inward, and he clenched his fist.
I'll tell you, as soon as I saw that guy, I knew he was trouble.
There's something seriously wrong with him, he glanced up, as if suddenly remembering that Leia was in the room, Your Majesty.
That guy is, I don't know, slime.
Slime. Leia exclaimed.
You're calling the Prince of Hapes slime?
Come off it, Han, you're just jealous.
You're right.
Maybe I am jealous.
Han admitted.
But that doesn't change my feelings.
Something is wrong here.
I can't shake this feeling that something's wrong.
Again he took on that same inward look.
Believe me, Your Highness. I've lived in the gutter most of my life.
I'm slime.
Most of my friends are slime.
And when you've been among slime as long as I have, you learn to spot it at a distance.
Leia didn't understand how Han could say such things. First to insult her by saying that he found it suspicious that another man might find her attractive, then to call the man a slime, all of it ran against her most deeply ingrained beliefs about how people should act toward one another.
I think, Leia said, shaking with anger, that maybe you ought to take your stupid plant and give it to the prince with your apologies.
You know, someday your slow wit and quick tongue are really going to get you in trouble.
Ah, you've been listening to Threkenhorn too much.
It's obvious he's trying to get you too cozy.
Did you know that your precious prince offered to give me a new battle cruiser if I promised to fly away and leave you two alone?
I tell you, the guy is slime.
Leia glared at Han, stuck a finger in his face.
Maybe, just maybe, you should accept his offer while you can still get something out of this deal.
Han stepped back a pace, wrinkled brow showing his frustration at the way the conversation was going.
Hey, look, Leia, Han apologized.
I don't know what's going on here.
I'm not trying to be difficult.
I know Isildur seems like a nice guy, but, last night in the galley I listened to people talk.
Everyone is talking.
As far as they're concerned, they've got you two married already.
And I'm here trying to hold on to you, and the harder I hold, the more you slip through my fingers.
Leia considered what to say.
Han was trying to apologize, but he didn't seem to realize that at this moment, she found his whole manner offensive.
Look, I don't know why people would even begin to think that I'd marry the prince.
I certainly haven't given anyone that impression.
So don't listen to them.
Listen to me.
I love you for what you are, remember?
A rebel, a scoundrel, a braggart.
That won't ever change.
But I think I need some time to myself for a few days.
All right?
In the silence that followed, communicator tones sounded.
Leia went to the little hollow unit in the corner, flipped the switch.
Yes.
A small image of Threkenhorn expanded in the air in front of her.
The old ambassador was resting his enormous weight on a daybed.
Folds of fat nearly concealed his pale blue eyes.
Princess, Threkken said jovially, we are convening a special session of the Alderaanian Council tomorrow.
I've already taken the liberty of calling the usual celebrities.
A special session of the council?
Leia asked.
But why?
What's wrong?
Nothing's wrong.
Threkken said.
Everyone has heard the good news of the Hapen's proposal.
Since the marriage of Alderaan's princess into one of the wealthiest families in the galaxy will affect all of us refugees, we thought it best to convene the council so that we could discuss the details of your impending marriage.
Thank you, Leia said angrily,
I'll be sure to attend. She punched the off button with disdain. Han gave her a knowing look, turned, and stormed from the room. In the sterile white corridors of the Rebel Dream, Han leaned against a wall and considered his options. His attempt at an apology had failed miserably, and Leia was probably right about Isildur. He seemed like a nice enough guy, and Han's concerns were probably bred out of jealousy. Yet Han had seen the yearning in Leia's eyes as she spoke of the peaceful worlds of Hapes. And Isildur was right. Even if Han won Leia's hand, what could he really give her? Certainly not the kind of wealth the Hapens offered. If Han convinced Leia to marry him, Alderaan's refugees would only lose in the end, and Threkenhorn stood at Leia's shoulder, reminding her of that fact every step of the way. Leia was endlessly loyal to her people. Han chuckled to himself. I think I just need some time to myself for a few days, Leia had said. He'd heard that line before. It's the one that is always followed a few days later by, have a nice life. Han could see only one way to match Isildur's wealth. Yet his heart hammered and his mouth went dry at the thought. He pulled a handheld communicator from his belt and thumbed a number, contacting an old acquaintance. The image of a huge, rubbery brown hut appeared on screen, looking out at Han with dark, drugged eyes. Dalla, you old thief, Han said with false enthusiasm. I need your help. I'd like to take out a loan on the Millennium Falcon, and I want you to get me into a card game tonight. A big one. Captain Astarda, the prince's personal guard, woke Isildur in his room. She was a woman of rare beauty, with long, dark red hair, and eyes as dark blue as the skies of her planet, Terrafon. Flared a Relorin. Was dinner spiced well? She asked, almost casually. As Isildur lay in bed, he watched her eyes scan the room more thoroughly than normal, her scrutiny moving from dresser to bed to closets. Her movements were fluid, cat-like. Dinner was spiced well, Isildur answered. I found the princess to be charming, good company. What is wrong? We picked up a coded message just an hour ago. It was beamed to all the ships in our fleet. We suspect it was an assassination order. The signal came from Hapes? No. It was beamed up to our fleet from Coruscant. Who was to be assassinated? The order did not name the target, or the time or place, Captain Astarda answered. The complete message reads, the temptress seems too interested. Take action. I know it's cryptic, but to me at least the meaning is clear. Did you notify New Republic security that Leia is in jeopardy? Astarda hesitated. I'm not convinced that Princess Leia is the target. Isildur did not say anything. If he died, the royal line would fall to his Aunt Sichia's daughter. Someone had also killed Isildur's betrothed once before, Lady Elier. They had found her drowned in a reflecting pool. Isildur could not prove his beliefs, but he was sure that his Aunt Sichia was behind the killing, just as he was sure that his aunt had hired the pirates who had assassinated his older brother, after sacking the royal flagship. The pirates would have known that the Chumda was worth a great deal to his mother, yet they had killed the boy without seeking a ransom. Isildur asked, so you think I am to be the target this time? I think so, my lord, Astarda answered. Your aunt could blame it on the outsiders, on factions within the New Republic, on some warlord who feared the marriage union, even on General Solo. Isildur sat up in bed, closed his eyes, thinking. His aunts and his mother, all were vicious women, cunning and deceitful. He had hoped that by marrying outside the Hapes royal line he would find someone like Leia, someone untainted by the avarice that plagued the women of his family. It hurt him to think that someone had managed to plant assassins in his own fleet. You will notify New Republic security of the threat. If my aunt has managed to plant an assassin on this ship, perhaps they can help uncover her identity. Beyond that, you will assign half of my personal guard to protect Leia. And who will protect you? Astarda asked. Isildur could see the sense of betrayal in her eyes. She loved him, could not neglect him. He had always known that. It was what made her so good at her job. Perhaps Astarte even hoped a little that Leia would die. Yet Isoldir knew that Captain Astarte would follow his orders. Above all, Astarte was an excellent soldier. He pulled a blaster from under the covers of his bed, saw the flicker of surprise in Astarte's eyes, at having missed the presence of a gun pointed at her chest. As always, Isoldir said, I will watch my own back.
Chapter 5.
That evening, Han found himself in a seamy dive in Coruscant's underworld, a casino that literally had not seen sunlight in more than 90,000 years, because layer upon layer of buildings and streets had been constructed over it, until the casino became wedged like a fossil in its layer of sediment. The moist air down here smelled of decay, yet for many races in the galaxy, those bred for life beneath ground, the underworld provided a habitat that they could thrive in. Deep within the gloomy shadows of the casino, Han could make out many pairs of large eyes, furtively watching. Han had asked to get into a high-stakes card game and had worked his way up through three lesser games, but he had never been prepared for anything like this. To his left sat a Kalumi counselor in an anti-grav harness, with a head so large that the blue, throbbing, worm-like veins around his cerebrum were far longer than his scrawny, useless legs. The Kalumi's vast intellect had made him one of the most feared gambling opponents in the galaxy. Across from Han sat Omog, a Drachmarian warlord known for her incredible wealth. Her pale blue scales were polished to a high gloss, and green clouds of methane inside her helmet hid her vicious teeth and snout. To his left sat the ambassador from Godel that Han had seen the day before, a gray-skinned, gray-bearded creature who played with his eyes closed, relying on the two huge sensory horns atop his head to probe the other players' emotions, hoping to read their minds. Han had never played sabacc among such company. In fact, Han had not played sabacc in years, and now sweat poured down his body, moistening his uniform. They played a variation on the game that hailed back millennia, a variation called Force Sabacc. In normal sabacc, a randomizer built into the table periodically altered the values of cards, giving the game an intensity and excitement that had kept it alive for generations. But under the rules of Force Sabacc, no randomizer was used. Instead, the randomness of the game was provided by the other players. After drawing the first card for a hand, each player had to call out if his or her hand would be light or dark. The player who played the strongest light or dark hand would win, but only if the combined strength of his or her chosen side won. For example, if Han chose to play a dark hand while all others played light, he would surely lose. Han stared at his cards, mixed cards, the two of sabers, the evil one, and the idiot. Altogether, a weak hand in the dark suit, and he didn't think it would be good enough. Han had won the last several pots by playing cards from the light arcana. Perhaps it was just superstition, but he felt that it wasn't a good time to be switching to the dark suit. Still, Han could only take the cards he had been dealt. I will call your bet, the Godel whispered to Han, not opening his red-rimmed eyes, and I'll raise you 40 million credits. Behind Han, Chewbacca whined, and 3PO bent close and whispered in Han's ear, may I remind you, sir, that the odds are 65,536-1, against anyone winning 8 hands in a row. He didn't have to say it aloud, but Han finished for him, and they are significantly less when the hand looks like this. I'll call, Han said, pushing forward the deed to the mineral rights of a dead star system whose name only the Kalumi could pronounce. And I'll raise you 80 million. He pushed over a stock chip that held a large percentage interest in the spice mines of Kessel. Han's nervousness must have overwhelmed the Godel, for the ambassador suddenly shielded his left sensory horn with his hand. The others saw how the Godel registered Han's sheer desperation and eagerly called the bet. Would anyone like to call the game now? Han asked. He hoped they would wait until another round had been dealt. I'll call the game, the Godel said. Each player laid his cards on the table. The Godel was playing a dark suit, but for the moment his was weaker than Han's. The two others were playing light suits and could potentially beat Han. They waited for the dealer droid, which was bolted to the ceiling above the table, to give each of them a last card. Overhead, gears squeaked as the arms of the ancient dealer rotated to place one in front of the Kalumi. The Kalumi touched it. The heat from his body activated the microcircuits in the card so that it displayed its picture, and Han's heart nearly stopped. The commander of coins, the commander of flasks, and the queen of air and darkness. At 22 points it was nearly an unbeatable hand. Han only hoped that the combined strength of the dark hands might outweigh it. The dealer dealt the final card to the Drachmarian. A picture of a Jedi Knight blossomed under her touch, moderation, upside down. The fact that moderation had been dealt upside down, reversed the Drachmarian's light hand, twisted it so that power was added to the dark hands of Han and the Godel. Han's heart leaped. This could turn it, this could turn the whole game. But under the rules, the Drachmarian could choose to discard one card. She pushed the upside-down moderation card away, keeping her light hand at only 16 points. The mechanical arms shifted over to the Godel, dropping a 7 of staves onto his deck. It was a minor card, but it served to strengthen the dark hand. The Godel held the Queen of Air and Darkness, Balance, and Demise. He came in at negative 19 points. Han felt a surge of elation, realizing that the dark hands would probably win. The Godel must have sensed Han's elation and mistaken it to mean that Han believed he personally had won. The Godel looked at Han's winnings jealously, then discarded his 7 of staves. Since his dark hand now totaled below negative 23 points, the hand was declared a bust, meaning that the dark arcana would automatically lose, unless Han could hit a natural 23, either positive or negative. Han studied his cards again. The idiot was worth nothing, the 2 of sabers was worth 2 points, while the evil one was worth negative 15. Han's best chance to win would be an idiot's array. He could keep his idiot card, plus the 2 of sabers, plus a 3 of any suit, thus making a literal 23. He figured the odds of getting a 3 were pretty bad, about 1 in 15, but it was the only shot in town. The mechanical hands rotated over Han, squeaking suddenly loud. The metal hands pulled out the top card from the deck, set it on the table, and Han reached out hesitantly, touched it. The second endurance card blossomed under his fingers. Negative 8 points. Han looked at his cards in disbelief, discarded the 2. At negative 23, he had a natural sabacc. "You've won," 3PO shouted, and the Godel ambassador collapsed and began making small barking noises that Han guessed could only be sobs. The Kalumi regarded Han coldly from enormous black eyes. "Congratulations, General Solo," the Kalumi said in a clipped tone. "I regret that this game has become too expensive for my tastes." The engines on his anti-grav unit fired, and he began to maneuver carefully from the room, taking care that his enlarged brain did not collide with any of the furnishings. The Godel ambassador pushed himself from the table, lunged away into the shadows of the underworld. "You are very rich, human," the Drachmarian warlord hissed through the speakers of her helmet. She set 2 gigantic paws on the table, scraping her talons over the ancient black metal. "Too rich. You may not make it out of the underworld alive." "I'll take my chances," Han said, slapping his hand against the blaster holstered at his side and gazing into the warlord's helmet. He could make out dark eyes, gleaming like wet stones through the green clouds of gas. Han pulled all of the credit chips, stock certificates, and deeds into a single enormous pile. Over 800 million credits. More credits than he had ever dreamed of owning. Yet still not enough. The Drachmarian reached across the table, and her claws dug into his wrist. "Stop," she hissed. "Another hand." Han considered, trying to appear calm. His mouth and tongue felt dry, but rather than lick his lips, he downed a mug of Corellian spiced ale. "Double or nothing?" he asked. The Drachmarian nodded, and the methane tubes leading to her helmet jiggled. Among the opponents that Han had been playing, she alone might possess what he wanted. A world. With so much money on the table, Omog could offer nothing less than a habitable world. Omog whispered to a security droid in the shadows at her back, and the droid swiveled guns toward Han, then popped open a vault in its belly. The Drakmarian pulled out a hollow cube. "This has been in family for many generations," the Drakmarian said. "It is worth 2.4 billion credits. I will sell you 1/3 interest in it now. If you win the next game, you will own the planet. If I win, I will own both the planet and the credits." She clawed a button on the cube, and the image of a planet appeared in the air. "Class M, nitrogen and oxygen atmosphere. 3 continents in a vast ocean." The hollow began rotating through a series of shots of two-legged herd beasts squatting to graze on a wide purple plain, a bluish sun setting over a tropical jungle, a flight of dazzling birds sweeping over the ocean like colored glass spilling across a blue tile floor.
"Perfect." Han began sweating again. "What's it called?"
"Dathomir," the Drakmarian breathed.
"Dathomir?" Han repeated, mesmerized. Chewbacca growled in warning, placed a restraining claw on Han's arm, begging him to be cautious. 3PO leaned close, and his prissy vocalizers cut through the clouds of smoke.
"May I remind you, sir, that the odds are 131,072-1, against you taking 9 hands in a row." When Leia answered her door chimes at the Alderaanian consulate, she found Han there, bathed in sweat, his hair a mess, his clothes looking baggy. He reeked of smoke and he smiled at her enormously, his bloodshot eyes gleaming with joy. He had a small box in his hand, wrapped in gold-colored foil.
"Look, Han, if you've come back to apologize, I forgive you, but I really don't have time for this now. I'm supposed to meet Prince Isildur in a few minutes and some Barabel spy wants to talk to me."
"Open it," Han said, shoving the box into her hand.
"Open it."
"What is it?"
Leia asked. She suddenly realized that the box wasn't just wrapped in gold-colored foil, it was wrapped in gold.
"It's yours," Han said. Leia untied the strings, pulled the foil open. It was a registry chip, one of the old kind, with a hollow cube built in. She thumbed the switch, watched the planet materialize in the air before her, a scene from space showing the planet, thin pink clouds shone at the edge of the terminus, dividing night from day, and generous storm clouds swirled out from the ocean. In the background, 4 small moons hovered. She studied the continents, green with life, vast purple savannas, exquisitely small ice caps at the poles.
"Oh, Han," she said, her breath coming ragged with excitement. Her whole face seemed to be lit up, glowing.
"What is its name?"
"Dathomir."
"Dathomir?" She frowned in concentration.
"I've heard of it, somewhere.
Where is it located?"
She suddenly turned all business.
"In the Drakmar system. I won it from Warlord Omog." She looked at the hollow, watched it sequence into its first picture, giant green herd beasts, possibly reptilian, grazing on a blue plain.
"This can't be in the Drakmar system," Leia said with certainty. "It's only got one sun."
She went to her console, locked into Coruscant's computer network, asking for the coordinates to Dathomir. It must have taken the huge computer bank some time to locate the files, for they waited nearly a minute before coordinates came up on screen. Leia looked into Han's face, saw his manic joy turn into a frown.
But that can't be," Han said.
"That's in the Quelii sector.
Warlord Zinj's territory."
Leia smiled regretfully, rubbed Han's hair as if he were a kid.
"Oh, you sweet, shaggy nerf herder. I knew it was too good to be true.
Still, it was kind of you to offer.
You know, you really are so kind to me."
She gave him a quick peck on the cheek. He stepped back in shock.
The Quelii sector.
"Go on home and get some sleep," Leia said, as if distracted.
"You won't do yourself any good thinking about it.
This ought to teach you never to play cards with a Drakmarian." She escorted him out the door of the Alderaanian consulate, and Han stood for a moment, rubbing his eyes, trying to keep awake and think at the same time. He looked up at the towering buildings above him, and the sunlight was thin, as if he were locked deep under a jungle canopy. He had imagined that Leia would love her new world, had imagined how she would collapse in his arms with joy. He'd planned to wait till that moment, then ask her to marry him. Yet, now all he had won was a worthless piece of real estate, and Leia had tousled his hair as if he were a kid brother. "I probably look pretty stupid right now," Han thought. Stupid and grungy. He jingled the money in his pocket, enough credit chips so he could get the Falcon out of Hawk. Fortunately, Chewbacca had had the foresight to pull that much out of the pot. Nearly 2 billion credits won and lost. Han was feeling too old to cry, almost. He stumbled back through the gray streets of Coruscant to a small apartment that he kept on planet, just hoping for some sleep. "You really shouldn't go to this meeting," Isildur said. "I don't like the idea of you traveling alone in the underworld." Leia smiled tolerantly at the prince. He was, after all, interested only in protecting her, but after tripping over his bodyguards for the past 2 days, she was beginning to wonder if he weren't overly protective. "I'll be all right," she said. "I've handled his kind before." "If his information is so important," Isildur said, "then why hasn't he given it to you already? Why insist on this meeting?" "He's a Barabel. You know how paranoid predators get when they're convinced someone is hunting them. Besides, if he really does have information about attack dates and battle plans, I'll need that information before we go to the Roche system. The Verpines have got to be warned." Isildur studied her with his clear, profound gaze. He wore a yellow half-cape, an enormous golden belt, and wide golden bracelets that accented the bronze color of his skin. He stepped forward, rested his hands lightly on her shoulders, and Leia's skin tingled at the contact. "If you insist on going into the underworld, then I am coming with you." Leia started to object, but he touched his finger to his lips. "Please, allow me this. I suspect you are right. I suspect that nothing will happen, but I could not live with myself if anything should happen to you." Leia studied his eyes, wanted to object, but there had been threats against her life. Isildur hinted that factions on Hapes would object to the Union, and already she had heard reports through the New Republic spy networks that warlords on the far side of the galaxy were making efforts to sabotage the Union. They didn't want the Hapen fleets adding their ships to the New Republic. Leia was already getting a taste of what it would be like to be the Queen Mother, wielding her might. "All right, you can accompany me," Leia said, and she admired Isildur for having the courtesy to ask to accompany her. Han would have demanded it. She wondered if Isildur's good manners were a natural part of his personality or if they had become ingrained simply because he was reared in a matriarchal society where women were shown greater respect. Whatever the case, she found it charming. He took Leia's arm, and they strolled out to the curb, flanked by Isildur's Amazon bodyguards, to wait under the marble porte-cochere for Leia's hover car. Old Threckenhorn came humming up the street in his repulsor chair. The broad streets here were fairly empty at this time in the morning, a couple of Ishi Tib strolling, an old droid painting the lampposts. Threkken greeted them casually, as if he just happened to be passing by, but he did not volunteer to leave. Instead, he thumbed the switch that stopped his chair and just sat, waiting for the hover car. "I hear that it's such a nice day up top," Threkken said, nodding toward the towering buildings above them, hover cars moving through slants of sunlight, "that I'm almost tempted to go sunbathing." "Almost." Isildur tenderly gripped Leia's arm, and Leia suddenly wished that Threkken would just get lost. She looked up at Isildur, and he smiled down as if sharing her thought. "Ah, here's your car now," Threkken said. A black hover car plowed down the street, slowed, swerved in close. The tinted glass in the passenger's window shattered as someone shoved a blaster barrel through. "Down," one of Isildur's bodyguards shouted, and the woman leaped in front of Leia as the first volley of red bolts cut through the air. One of the bolts caught the woman in the chest, lifted her and threw her back. Gouts of blood glittered in the air, and Leia smelled the familiar stench of ozone and charred flesh. Threkenhorn cried out and hit a button on his repulsor chair, he went hurtling south as fast as if he were in a land speeder, shouting at the top of his lungs. Isildur pushed Leia back behind one of the broad pillars of the porte-cochere and was a blur of motion as he whipped off his belt. Part of it, a small gold shield, he held in his left hand, and from somewhere he drew a small blaster. Leia heard a humming noise and a second volley issued from the car, but the red flaming bolts hit the air in front of them, exploded harmlessly. A thin, blue, circular haze shimmered before Isildur, white at the edges, like a ring around a moon on a cold night. Personal shielding, she realized. Leia was suddenly conscious that the remaining Amazon bodyguard was behind her, taking momentary advantage of the shielding to shout into a handheld comlink for a backup. A burst of blaster fire whizzed past Leia's head, hitting the marble above them, and Leia turned. The droid that had been painting on the corner fired a blaster at them.
Astarda! Get the droid! Isildur shouted.
The prince's shield couldn't cover them in the crossfire, and they couldn't count on the marble pillars for much protection. Leia lunged for the dead Amazon's blaster, fired off two quick rounds, enough so that the droid hid behind his lamppost. It was only then that Leia registered the oddly erect main body, the bullet-shaped head and long legs. An Eliminator Assassin droid, Model 434. Astarda joined her, in opening fire on it. The hover car stopped, and two men leaped out, firing. Leia knew that Isildur's personal shield couldn't hold for more than a couple more seconds. Personal shielding tended to provide minimal protection, because you couldn't get a power source strong enough to deflect enemy fire and still last for more than a moment. The second danger came from the shield itself. The energy shield got so hot that the wielders risked frying themselves if they accidentally touched it. Isildur held the shield before him, lunged at his attackers. Two more bolts whizzed past his head, and Astarda fired. Leia looked just in time to see the Amazon's single bolt hit the assassin droid at mid-torso. Metal bits flew into the air, followed by a massive explosion as the droid's power plant exploded. The prince swung his shield as a weapon, and its energy field knocked his attackers backward. Blue sparks erupted in the air as it made contact. One man cried out and dropped his blaster, holding his burned face. Isildur raised the shield over his head, spun it and tossed it at the last attacker. The shielding caught the assassin in the chest, sliced through him like a lightsaber, and then Isildur stood alone with his blaster, aiming it at the remaining assassin, who was screaming in agony, clutching his face. He once had been a handsome man, Leia thought.
Too handsome.
A Hapen.
Who hired you?
Isildur demanded. The assassin screamed out, Laryl.
Remarm.
Tabai Larvan. Isildur asked in Hapen.
At.
Remarm, the assassin begged. Isildur kept the gun leveled at the assassin a second longer, and the man shouted again. A piece of burned flesh tore away from his face. The man leaped into the gutter for his gun, and Isildur hesitated. The assassin fumbled for the gun, pointed it at his own face, and pulled the trigger. Leia turned away. Suddenly Isildur's bodyguard was pulling at Leia's arm, yelling, "Inside, get inside," and Isildur grabbed Leia, took her back into the house. There was an alcove by the door where guests could hang their coats, and Isildur pulled Leia toward the alcove, then stood protecting her, breathing hard and looking out into the hallway. The bodyguard, Astarda, had bolted the door. As on most of the consulates, Leia's door was made of ancient blastplate and could withstand even a sustained assault. The bodyguard was yelling into her communicator again. Leia couldn't understand Hapen, but the guard was making a lot of noise.
Who sent them?
Leia asked.
He wouldn't say, Isildur answered briefly.
He only begged me to kill him. Outside, through the walls, Leia could hear New Republic forces shouting as they sought to secure the area. Isildur stood panting, listening intently, probably trying to eavesdrop on both his bodyguard and the police outside, make sure it was safe. He held Leia lightly, protectively, and her heart hammered. She pushed at him gently, and said,
thank you for saving me.
Prince Isildur focused on the sounds around him so strongly that at first he seemed not to notice that she was pushing him away. Then he looked down into her eyes. He lifted her chin and kissed her forcefully, passionately, and stepped in closer so that the entire length of him pressed against her. Leia's mind seemed to go white, and her whole body felt electric. Her jaw was trembling, but she kissed him long and slowly, the seconds ticking away far slower than the pounding in her chest. With each second she could think of only one thing: I'm betraying Han. I don't want to hurt Han. But then Isildur whispered into her ear, demanding. Come away with me to Hapes. Come see the worlds you will rule. Leia found herself crying, had never really imagined that she would let something like this happen. But at that moment, whatever attachment she had ever felt for Han suddenly seemed to become as insubstantial as fog, as a gentle white mist, and Isildur was the sun, burning it all away. With tears running down her cheeks, she tangled her arms around Isildur, and promised, I'll come with you. Chapter 6.
I don't know why I asked you here, Han said to 3PO, waving his hand in an expansive gesture. They sat in a booth in a cantina on Coruscant. It was a tame place by any standards, clear air, couples dancing slowly to the sound of Ladurian nose flutes. Chewbacca looked up from his drink with weary eyes and growled. Chewie knew Han was lying. He knew exactly why Han asked 3PO there. 3PO glanced at both of them, and his logic drive told him to probe further. Is there anything I can help you with, sir?
Well, see, you've been closer to Leia over the last couple of days than I have, Han said, hunching his shoulders. She hasn't exactly been happy with me, and she's spending all of her time with that prince, and after what happened to them this morning, they are so tightly surrounded by bodyguards that you can hardly get a glimpse of them. And now Leia left me a hollow message to say she might be going to Hapes. 3PO studied the words for 3.12 seconds, searching through layer after layer of innuendo and unspoken meanings.
I see, he said. You too are having diplomatic problems. Although 3PO was a translator with some of the finest programming in the galaxy, his human friends seldom called on his talents when dealing with their own complex emotional entanglements. 3PO perceived immediately that Han was placing an inordinate amount of trust in his abilities. This would be a rare opportunity to prove himself.
You've certainly come to the right droid. How may I help you?
I don't know, Han said. You see them together a lot. I was just wondering, you know, how things are going. Are they really getting that close?
3PO immediately accessed all visual records where he'd seen Leia and Isildur together over the last couple of days. Dinners 3 nights in a row, council meetings where the two of them discussed potential difficulties in negotiating a settlement between the Verpines and the Barabels, just walking, dancing at a party for a minor dignitary. Well, sir, during their first day together, Prince Isildur kept an average distance of 0.562 decimeters between himself and Leia, C-3PO said, but that space is closing rapidly. I would say that the two of them are becoming very close indeed.
How close?
Han asked. Over the past 8 standard hours, the two have been touching nearly 86% of the time. 3PO's infrared optical sensors picked up a slight brightening as blood rushed to Han's face. He quickly apologized, I'm sorry if this news disturbs you.
Han downed a mug of Corellian rum.
Since it was his second in the past few minutes, 3PO quickly calculated Han's body mass and the alcohol content of the rum and decided that Han was more than mildly inebriated. Yet the primary manifestation of the intoxication seemed to be only a slight slowing of his speech. Han placed a hand on 3PO's metal arm.
You're a good droid, 3PO.
You're a good droid.
There's not many droids I like as much as I like you.
I don't know, what would you do if some droid prince was trying to muscle in on the woman you loved?
3PO's sensors picked up heavy emanations of alcohol from Han's breath, and he leaned away to avoid any corrosion to his processors.
The first thing I would do, 3PO proffered,
would be to gauge the opposition and see what I have to give that the opposing party does not.
Any good counselor droid could tell you that.
Aha, Han said. So, what do I have to offer Leia, that Isildur doesn't?
Well, let's see, 3PO said. Isildur is extremely wealthy, generous, well-mannered, and, at least by human standards, attractive.
So, now all that we need to do is see what you have to offer that he doesn't have.
3PO searched his files for several moments, overheating his memory drives.
Oh dear, he whined at last.
I see your problem.
Well, there's always emotional attachment, I suppose.
I'm certain that Leia won't forget about you just because a better man has come along.
I love her, Han said emphatically. I love her more than I love my own life, more than breath.
When she touches me I feel like, I don't know how to say it.
Have you told her?
3PO asked.
Like I say, Han sighed, I just don't know how to say it.
You're a counselor droid.
He poured another rum, just stared at it.
Do you know how to say it?
Do you know any songs or poems?
Indeed.
I carry masterpieces from over 5 million cultures in my memory banks.
Here is one of my favorites, from the Chukthai.
Han listened to the gentle music of the words, the soft curling snarls, the muted thunder.
That sounds pretty good, Han admitted.
What does it mean?
C-3PO translated it as closely as possible.
When lightning rushes over the evening plains, I return to my cold den, with a Thula rat in my jaws.
Then, I smell your sweet spore,
smeared on the bones by the cave's maw.
Then, my head fins begin to tremble, and my tail sways majestically,
as my mating howl begins to fill the hollow of the night.
Han stopped him with a wave of the hand.
All right, I get the picture.
There's much, much more, 3PO assured him.
It really is a beautiful epic, all 500,000 lines of it.
Yeah, yeah, thanks, Han said, sounding as disheartened as ever.
He sat, listening to a foursome who had just sat down at another table, and 3PO realized that over the past minute, Han had been focusing on them.
3PO downloaded his auditory tracks and played back the conversation of those at the other table to find out what so intrigued Han.
First woman.
Oh, look, there's General Solo.
Second woman.
Gee, he looks pretty bad.
Look at those bags under his eyes.
First man.
Kind of scruffy looking, if you ask me.
Second woman.
It makes you wonder what Leia ever saw in him, anyway.
First woman.
Now that prince from Hapes, he is so gorgeous.
Down on Coruscant, street merchants are selling posters of him.
Second man.
Yeah, I bought one for my sister.
First man.
As for me, I'd take one of his bodyguards any day.
First woman.
With a body like his, I'd kill to be his guard.
Second woman.
Well, you can guard that body all you want, I'd rather be his masseuse.
Can you imagine needing that hot flesh all day long?
Han said angrily, look, 3PO, why don't you keep an eye on Leia?
If she asks about me, tell her I miss her.
All right.
3PO stored the request.
As you wish, sir, he said, rising to leave the bar.
Chewbacca growled a goodbye to the spy.
3PO made his way out into the streets, and wandered down chasms toward one of Coruscant's central computers that had a reputation as something of a gossip.
Such a computer would gladly tell a droid secrets that it would never reveal to a biological life form.
So Han needed a diplomatic counselor.
This would be a wonderful opportunity for C-3PO to prove himself.
A wonderful opportunity.
Threkin Horm looked his best, dressed in a long, dark green waistcoat and white pants, his thinning hair meticulously curled so that ringlets danced around his ears.
Leia noticed that he didn't look as fat as usual when he stood under his own power, and he was standing now at the podium.
As you all know,
I have called this session of the Alderaanian Council so that we can discuss preparations for Princess Leia's marriage to Prince Isildur, the Chunda of Hapes. The crowd erupted into vigorous applause. The plush council room with its curtained walls and plum-colored chairs could hold nearly 2,000 people, yet only 100 members of the council were present. The rest of the seating was occupied by curious onlookers, while the back of the hall was a gleaming forest of metallic media droids. Leia sat in her seat on the front row, only a couple of meters from where Threkin stood on the podium. Han sat in a back row, dressed casually in a white shirt and vest, looking very much the way he had when they'd first met, years ago. Chewbacca sat beside him. Leia had intended to discuss her plans here bluntly but hadn't been prepared for so much media attention. In the past day she suddenly found her entire life in the spotlight. The attempted assassination of the morning before had been covertly filmed from 8 different angles and was playing on all the stations. New Republic intelligence officers had swept the embassy for bugs this morning and found microphones with open channels to 15 networks. It seemed that the only thing the public liked better than a royal marriage was a royal assassination, and the media hounds were lapping this up. Leia's only consolation was that if another assassin struck, he or she would have to shoot through the camera operators to get her. Ah well, best to get this over with. Threkin, members of the council, Leia said, standing. I would like to thank you all for coming here, but don't you think this is a bit premature? I agree that this seems like a marvelous offer, but I haven't consented to marry Prince Isildur yet. She sat down again. Oh, Leia, Threkin said, with a condescending smile. Often, in the past, your clear head and cautiousness have served you well. But in this particular case. He shrugged. I've seen how you two look at each other, and you have agreed to a 6-month excursion with Isildur, touring the worlds of Hapes. I think it's a grand idea. It will give you and Isildur a little time to grow closer while the royal house of Hapes gets an opportunity to see how well that pretty little head of yours wears a crown. The crowd tittered with nervous laughter at the jest. Let's put it before the council. Threkin waved at the seated assemblage. Don't you all think that Leia and Isildur make a beautiful couple? Most of the professional politicians remained somewhat somber, but many of the traders snickered while members of the media and audience cheered and clapped. This didn't look at all to Leia like a normal council meeting, this looked like a carnival. You can't plan my wedding without me. Leia interrupted, rising from her seat, astonished at Threkin's audacity. Isildur understands, as I'm sure that you must, that we aren't engaged, either formally or informally. I'm going to Hapes simply to. And she realized the truth. Isildur was taking her to Hapes so that the planetary dignitaries she might someday rule could study her, measure her for the crown. And she was going so that she could have time to get closer to Isildur. It was just as Threkin said. No matter how she might try to deny it, everyone else in the galaxy could see what was happening. She glanced over at Han. He looked miserable. She sat down, tried not to blush, intensely conscious that this encounter was already being carried live over dozens of news nets. She knew she should argue against Threkin, if only to save face, but right now she just couldn't think. For the first time in her life, Leia was at a loss for words. Indeed, indeed we can't plan your wedding without you, Threkin assured her from the podium. We wouldn't think of it. We are only making plans in the eventuality that you marry Isildur. Councilman Horm. C-3PO's voice cut through the council room. Leia turned, saw the golden droid standing on tiptoe and waving from the back of the room excitedly. Oh, Councilman Horm, may I address the council? What? Horm asked in disdain. Let a droid address the council. Leia smiled inwardly. The droid rights lobbyists would have a field day with that comment. It might well be the first nail in the coffin for Horm's political career. Leia stood quickly. He may only be a counselor droid, but I think we should let him speak. There was grumbled assent from the General Assembly, along with deafening cheers from the forest of media droids in the back. I see nothing wrong with that.
Horn sputtered, waving his arms. I yield the podium to, that droid. The media droids cheered and 3PO walked up to the podium, scanning the crowd on his left and right as he did so. Leia had never seen a droid take such initiative. She wondered what he wanted. 3PO reached the podium and turned to address the crowd. Well, he said, I would like to propose that the council should begin planning Leia's wedding, to General Han Solo. What? Shouted Horm. Why this is preposterous. General Solo isn't even royalty. He's just. Horm must have realized that he had better not say anything libelous, but he shrugged in disgust. All through the crowd, a wave of grumbling began, and Leia wondered if she hadn't misjudged in letting poor 3PO address the council. I beg to differ. 3PO answered. I have been communicating with various computers through Coruscant's network all morning, and I've discovered some startling facts that all of you seem to have overlooked, possibly because General Solo has labored intensely to hide them. Although the Corellians became a republic nearly 3 centuries ago, by birthright, Han Solo is the king of Corellia. The room erupted in a dull roar and media droids began hitting Han Solo with spotlights. Threkenhorm's nasal voice sliced through the chatter with, what? Leia turned and looked to the back of the room in shock. The back seats of the auditorium were raised in tears, and she could see Han plainly, blushing, trying to scrunch down into his seat. From the look on his face, she could tell that Han was indeed trying to hide something. And Leia knew that 3PO's programming as a counselor droid made him incapable of lying. Han put his hand up over his eyes and looked down at the floor. In all these years, why didn't he ever tell me? Leia wondered. Aboard the Bith counselor ship, Thifit, Luke watched the hollow vid with interest, surprised that even on a backwater world like Tula, the doings of Leia and Isildur, and now Han, could be of enough interest to warrant the enormous expense it cost to send the news clips through hyperspace. Well, Leia was living every woman's fantasy, attracting the interest of an incredibly rich and handsome prince. And the intrigue of the assassination attempt had escalated the worth of the story, so that now Luke could watch his sister live, nearly 300 light-years distant. The Bith ship was scheduled to jump into hyperdrive within a few moments, and Luke studied the video with interest. The hollow vid cameras were focused on Han now, and Solo sat scrunched in his chair, hand over his face. Even Chewbacca, sitting next to Han, opened his eyes wide in surprise, a throaty roar of astonishment escaping from between his canines. Luke smiled inwardly. Of course, he thought, Han is a king. I should have recognized it before. But why did he hide it? In spite of his smile, Luke felt troubled. He could feel something odd, something distant and dark stirring. Too many in the galaxy would resist Leia's union to Isildur. He could feel the force of their malevolent intent, and Luke silently willed the Bith technicians to hurry and finish their equipment tests before making the jump to hyperdrive. Luke wouldn't reach the Roche system any too soon. Indeed, 3PO went on. Han is the royal heir. Birth records indicate that Han's paternal ancestry goes back to Barethron Solo, who introduced democracy in the Corellian Empire. You can easily track the birthright for the next 6 generations, to Coral Solo, but records from Coral's period were destroyed in the Clone Wars, and the lineage became lost. But Coral Solo married and fathered his first son on Duro nearly 60 years ago, and because of the wars and turmoil, that son never returned home. His name was Dalla Solo, but he changed his name to Dalla Sol, to hide his identity during the Clone Wars. His firstborn son was Jonash Sol, and the first son of Jonash Sol was named Han Sol, who changed his name back to Han Solo. Obviously, Han knew of his royal lineage, but for reasons that are quite beyond me, he's also tampered with records back on Corellia in an effort to hide that lineage. There was an audible gasp from the crowd, and Threkenhorm shouted for order. Han got up slowly and walked out of the auditorium as the roar in the background diminished. Leia half stood, watching Han leave, and the crowd quieted enough for Threkin to cry out,
but wasn't Dalla Sol also known as Dalla the Black? The famous murderer. Well, yes, I suppose, 3PO admitted, though the history texts describe him more accurately as a kidnapper and a pirate. And, well, Threkken said, well, what kind of lineage is that? I mean, Dalla Sol was one of the most notorious kingpins in organized crime. You can't expect respectable people to give any credence to Han's claims of royal lineage. Well, I am just an ignorant droid and confess that I don't really understand how the actions of one's ancestors enhance or detract from one's respectability, 3PO apologized to Threkken Horm. Such concepts are beyond the ability of a Model AA-1 Verbobrain to process. But since Dalla Sol's illegitimate daughter was your mother, I expect that you are infinitely more familiar with the logic of the arguments than I am. Threkken Horm's face paled, and he stood shaking. The holovid clip ended, and a droid announcer began commenting on it. Luke flipped off the holo and sat back in a thick chair, folded his hands on his lap. In only a couple of generations, Han's line had diminished from kingship to underworld kingpin. No wonder Han had hidden his lineage, had turned his back on the Alderaanian Council, and stormed away before his secret was revealed. Poor Han. Chapter 7. That afternoon, Leia and Isildur strolled through a secluded forest in the botanical gardens of Coruscant, a garden where plants from hundreds of thousands of New Republic worlds flourished. Leia was showing Isildur the Oro woods of Alderaan, forests where the graceful, clean-limbed trees climbed hundreds of feet into the air, but every inch of the tree's bark was covered with iridescent lichen colonies that glimmered in colors of cinnabar, violet, and canary, like the effluent of rainbows. White Kairoka birds fluttered from limb to limb, while tiny brilliant red deer with golden stripes fed among foliage on the ground. On Alderaan, the Oro woods had occupied only a dozen small islands, and Leia had only traveled there once as a child. Still, seeing that even a piece of her home world still thrived lightened her heart. Isildur walked hand in hand with her. He said, "I called my mother on Holovid. She was pleased that you planned to come visit. She's bringing her own personal vehicle to carry you back to Hapes." Vehicle? Leia wondered aloud at his choice of words. "You mean she's bringing her own personal ship?" "In this case," Isildur said, "I think the word vehicle is more appropriate. It's thousands of years old and rather eccentric in design. Still, you will like it." The woods were quiet. Isildur's bodyguards had spread out among the trees, except for the woman Astarda, who walked at their backs. Leia smiled, stopped to smell a violet, trumpet-shaped flower. The flower had been uncommon on the plains of her home world, a pungent-smelling weed. "This is an arrowroot," Leia said. Folktales said that if a new bride found one growing in her yard, it was a sign that she would soon have a child. Of course, the bride's mother and sisters always made it a point to plant an arrowroot in the newlywed's lawn after the wedding, and of course, they had to do it at night. It was considered bad luck to get caught. Isildur smiled, fingered the flower. "When it dries," Leia said, "the petals fold in and the seeds get trapped in the dry flower. Mothers then give the dry flowers to their babies to use as rattles." "How charming," Isildur said, and he sighed. "It's sad to know that it's all gone, all destroyed. Except for what's here on Coruscant. When our refugees find a new home," Leia said, "we plan to take some of these specimens with us, establish another garden on a new world." Comlink tones sounded, and Leia flipped her comlink on, reluctantly. "Leia, Threkken Horm here. I have great news. The New Republic has cancelled your mission to the Roche system." "What?" Leia asked, stunned. She had never been pulled from an assignment. "How did this happen?" "It seems that relations between the Verpines and the Barabels are disintegrating at a faster rate than we anticipated," Threkken answered. "So Mon Mothma has escalated the level of intervention in hopes that we can avert a war. General Han Solo will be assigned to lead a fleet of Star Destroyers to the Roche system to protect the Verpines until the crisis is resolved. Meanwhile,
Mon Mothma personally will be handling this crisis with a team of her most trusted counselors.
What crisis?
Leia asked. Customs agents boarded a Barabel cargo ship outside the Roche system this morning and found the thing we all feared. Leia's stomach turned at the thought of lockers filled with verpine body parts, hard frozen in the depths of space. In spite of her attempts to overcome such prejudices, the more Leia dealt with species of carnivorous reptiles, the more she anticipated such atrocities. Still, she told herself, you couldn't judge an entire species by the actions of a few.
What of Mon Mothma? Won't she need my help?
She and I both feel that there are better ways for you to serve the New Republic, Threkin said. Mon Mothma has temporarily relieved you from duty for the next 8 standard months. I trust your time will be well spent. The undertone to his voice clearly indicated what he desired, but he said it outright.
You may leave for Hapes at your earliest convenience.
Threkin's image flicked off the communicator, and Isildur squeezed Leia's hand. Leia considered momentarily, and knew she could not argue against Horn. The Verpines really would be better off with a New Republic fleet at their side, and Leia had felt overwhelmed by the assignment all along. As a diplomatic counselor, she had great skills, but the Barabels were never impressed by stirring speeches or elaborate arguments. The Barabels, who had evolved as communal predators dominated by a pack leader, would respect Mon Mothma for handling the affair. The simple fact that the pack leader for the entire New Republic had jumped into the fray would disorient the Barabels, force them to regroup and rethink the situation. In fact, now that Leia looked at it, she realized that Mon Mothma didn't need her at all. Leia had been so curious, trying to understand why a Verpine hive mother would be allowed to go feral, that she had been planning to attack the problem from the wrong angle. She should have been looking at the Barabels all along. Perhaps the only thing that didn't make a great deal of sense would be to send a New Republic fleet to the Roche system. The Verpines could protect their hives. With their ability to communicate via radio waves, the fact that their colonies were built in an asteroid belt that was non-navigable, at least by human pilots, and their swarming attack style in high-speed B-wing bombers, the Verpines would make a formidable foe.
Isildur stepped in closer. Why are you frowning, little one?
Just wondering about something.
No, you are worrying, Isildur said.
Don't you think Mon Mothma has things in control?
Too much control, Leia said, and she looked up into the stormy seas of his gray eyes.
You aren't ready to leave yet, are you?
Isildur asked.
Leia started to speak, but Isildur added, no, no, that is all right. Leaving all of this behind, he gestured to the Oro woods around him, will be a big step for you. It will feel as if you are leaving it for good, and perhaps, if you so choose, you will indeed be leaving these worlds, this life, behind.
He held her hands, and Leia smiled wistfully.
Isildur said, take a few days.
Spend some time with your friends.
Say your goodbyes if you feel that you must.
I understand.
And if it makes you feel any better, then just repeat what you said to the Alderaanian Council.
You are coming to Hapes for a visit, nothing more.
There are no strings attached, no obligations.
His words slid over her, like a wave of warm water, buoying her spirits.
Oh, Isildur, thank you for understanding.
She leaned into his chest, and Isildur put his arms around her.
For a moment, Leia was tempted to add, I love you, but knew it was too soon to speak those words, knew it was too much of a commitment.
Isildur whispered softly into her ear, I love you.
Han Solo sat at the console of the Millennium Falcon, running dodge maneuvers through an orbital junkyard of space debris off Coruscant's smallest moon. Doing computer checks of all flight systems on his ship was one thing, but Han had long ago decided that only a live test was sufficient. Flying through a junkyard was much like negotiating through an asteroid field, except that the junk here tended to be all heavy metal, unlike those nice, soft carbonaceous asteroids. Threading his way through the debris somehow seemed to ease Han, tranquilize him.
He dipped under the slowly tumbling busted stabilizer wing of a TIE fighter and then came up to the skeletal hull of an old Victory Star Destroyer, long since gutted for salvage. Just what I want, he thought. There were some systems aboard the Falcon that just couldn't be tested in friendly space, and where Han was headed, he didn't expect to meet any friendlies. He slowed to match the Star Destroyer's velocity, nosed into the main exhaust nacelle, up to where its turbodrive generator had once been housed, then carefully set the Millennium Falcon down. Han flipped on his modified Imperial IFF transponder, switched it to option 14. As his ship's radio signals bounced against the metal shielding of the fission chamber, Han's proximity indicators screamed in warning of approaching enemy INCOM Y4 passenger ships in every direction, their blue-gray metallic images flickering on the head-up holo display. Han had salvaged the transponder code from a military transport ship attached to Warlord Zinja's Marines. The transport ship had been carrying a 12-member team from Zinja's Raptors, a special forces organization supposedly devoted to surveying planetary defense systems, then infiltrating said planets and demolishing their defenses. But the Raptors were developing a nasty reputation as the strong arm of Zinja's secret police. Ultimately, on many thousand worlds, the Raptors ruled. Secure in the knowledge that his new transponder signal would identify him as one of Zinja's ships, Han flipped on his jammers, and so much static and radio traffic came over his sensors that the ghost ships blanked out on his head-up display. Han smiled inwardly. Both the new transponder and the high-powered jammers were working fine. He'd need them in unfriendly space. Now that he'd tested his hardware, Han fired his sublight engines and carefully lifted the Falcon out of the rusting innards of the old destroyer. As he maneuvered through the orbiting junkyard, the call he'd been waiting for came on audio. Leia said, "General Solo, I hear that you'll be taking a fleet to the Roche system tonight." "Yeah, that's what they tell me," Han said. "I'll be sorry to see you go. I was hoping we could get together for a few hours before you leave." A fleet? She thought he was leading a fleet. One Star Destroyer could hardly be called a fleet. Han knew who was behind the orders, who had stabbed him in the back. Threkken Horm. Han had underestimated the fat man, and now they planned to ship him off, far, far away, so that Leia would forget about him. "Yes," Han said. "That would be nice. I'm kind of busy right now, trying to get a grip on a few things. I can't come down planetside. Maybe I could meet you at 1500 hours, at your place. Aboard the Rebel Dream? We could maybe talk a little, go out for a drink." "That sounds good. I'll see you then." Leia signed off. Han glanced at the timepiece on his console. Chewbacca and 3PO were supposed to meet him on the Millennium Falcon at 1700 hours. Time was running out. When Han came to Leia's door, he had a tired smile on his face. He gave Leia a quick hug, then entered the hallway to her quarters, glancing around nervously. She stepped back to look at him. His hair was mussed, eyes fatigued. He didn't look happy at all. "Can I get you a drink or something?" Leia asked. Han shook his head. No. He didn't say anything else, just stood, looking at the walls and glancing into the living quarters. In Leia's bedroom, the dull lights shone from the gems of Galanor on her dresser. The twin suns above the Salab tree had gone dark, as if they were on a night cycle. "You aren't happy about your transfer to the Roche system, are you?" Leia asked. "Well, to tell the truth, I'm not going," Han admitted. "Not going?" Leia asked. "I resigned my commission." "When did this happen?" Leia asked. Han shrugged. 5 minutes ago. He walked into her bedroom, stood staring down at the bed, glanced at the gems on her dresser, the piles of treasure from Hapes. Part of Leia was still surprised to have it here. If she'd had any sense, she told herself, she would have had it locked up. "Well, where will you go?" Leia demanded. "What will you do?"
I'm going to Dathomir, Han said, and Leia stood with her mouth open a moment.
You can't go there, she said. That's in Zinja's territory. It's too dangerous.
Before I resigned, I ordered the Indomitable to run a strike and fade against some of Zinja's outposts on the edge of New Republic space. Zinja will be forced to fortify those outposts, drawing any ships away from Dathomir, and I should be able to just slip between the cracks.
He won't even know that I'm there.
That, Leia said loudly, is an abuse of authority. Han turned his interest from the gems, looked up at her and grinned.
I know.
Leia didn't say anything else. When he got in one of these headstrong moods, she knew she couldn't talk any sense into him.
He shrugged again.
No one will get hurt. I ordered them to attack only with long-range drones.
Our soldiers will be okay.
You know, I think I must have been looking at that hollow of the planet too long. I dreamed about it last night. Running on the beach, the wind in my face, water slapping against my ankles. It was all so sweet. So when I got my orders today, I just decided.
I'm going.
What will you do there?
If I like it, maybe I'll just stay.
It's been a long time since I've felt sand beneath my feet.
Too long.
You're burned out, Leia said.
Don't resign your commission.
I'll pull some strings, get you reassigned.
You can have a few weeks off.
Han had been looking at the floor, but now he turned his attention to her, studied her face.
We're both tired, he said.
We're both burned out.
Why don't you come with me, run away?
I can't do that, Leia said.
That's what you're planning to do with Isildur.
Run away.
Why can't you give me equal time?
Chewie and 3PO are going to meet me at the Falcon in an hour.
You could come with us.
Who knows, maybe you'd fall in love with Dathomir.
Maybe you would fall back in love with me.
He sounded so pitiable.
Leia felt guilty for the past few days, for ignoring him, deserting him.
She remembered how she'd felt the day that Vader had encased Han in carbonite, shipping him back to Jabba the Hutt. The joy they had shared when the Emperor was vanquished.
She'd loved him then.
But that was a long time ago, she told herself.
Look, Han, I'll always be fond of you, Leia found herself saying.
I know it's hard.
But have a nice life.
Han asked.
Leia found herself shaking.
Han strolled over to her dresser, and Leia saw that he was looking at the polished black metal of the gun of command.
Does this really work? He asked.
He started to reach for it, and Leia realized what he planned, shouted, "Don't touch that!"
Han snatched the gun and spun, faster than she would have believed possible.
He stood pointing it at her.
Come with me to Dathomir.
You can't do this.
Leia pleaded, raising a hand as if it could ward off the blast.
I thought you loved rogues, Han said.
A spray of blue sparks erupted from the gun, bringing forgetfulness and the night.
Are you sure that General Solo kidnapped the princess? The Queen Mother asked.
Even though his mother's image was only carried on Holovid, Prince Isildur dared not look up at her veiled face.
Yes, Tai Chum, he answered.
A news network planted a fly eye in the hallway leading to her quarters, and it filmed Leia leaving her quarters with the general.
She walked like one who is dreaming, and Solo was armed with the gun of command.
So, what steps will you take to recover the princess?
Isildur could feel the weight of the Tai Chum's stare.
The Queen Mother was testing him.
On Hapes, the women in authority often spoke deprecatingly of the ineptitude of men, their seeming inability to ever do anything right.
The New Republic has already assembled 1,000 of their best detectives to track down Han Solo.
Astarda has secured hourly progress reports, and we have put out calls for bounty hunters.
The Tai Chum spoke softly, menacingly.
Look into my eyes.
Isildur gazed up at her, tried to relax.
His mother wore a circlet of gold, and a thin yellow veil obscured her features. The lights around her lit the gold so that she seemed almost to generate an aura of power. Isildur focused beyond the veil, at her dark eyes boring into him. "This General Solo is a desperate man," she said. "I know what you are thinking. You want to rescue Princess Leia from his clutches yourself. But you must remember your duty to your people. You are the Chumda. Your wife and daughters must someday reign. If you place yourself in jeopardy, you will be betraying the hopes and dreams of your people. You must let our assassins handle General Solo. Promise me." Isildur stared hard into his mother's face, tried to hide his intent, but it was no use. She knew him too well. She knew everyone too well. "I will hunt down General Solo," Isildur said. "And I will bring home my bride." Isildur waited for his mother to explode, waited for the hot wrath in her voice to pour over him like magma. He could feel it in the silence that followed, but the Tai Chum was not the kind of woman to show her anger. She said calmly, almost with a sigh, "You disobey me lightly, but no matter what you think, your tendency toward selfless heroics is no virtue. I would cure you of it if I could." She did not speak for a moment, and Isildur waited for her to pronounce his punishment. "I suppose you're too much like your father. General Solo will probably seek refuge with one of the warlords, someone who might hope to withstand the might of the New Republic. I will gather my assassins and bring a fleet to Coruscant immediately. It goes without saying that if I find Solo before you do, I will kill him." Isildur let his gaze drop to the floor. Isildur had wildly hoped that now that Leia had been abducted, his mother would forego this trip, stay away. But it made sense. Solo had kidnapped her successor. Honor demanded that she take all steps to recover the princess. "I know you are displeased. Yet when I was a child you often said, 'Hapes can only be as strong as those who lead her.' I often reflect on your words, and I've taken them to heart." He ended the communication, sat back and considered. Isildur almost pitied Han. General Solo could not possibly guess the kind of resources his mother would bring to bear on him. Corporal Reason had somehow managed to work in the military for 7 years in relative obscurity, never attracting the praise or attention he felt to be his due. All too often, that is how it went in military intelligence. You scraped and slaved for years to break a big case, hoping that some useful information might cross your way. That is why he planned to send this report to Warlord Zinj directly, for his eyes only, signing his name to the documents so that none of his superiors could take credit. It was only fair. Corporal Reason was the only person to notice it. 3 strike and fades over a period of 9 days, maneuvers designed to draw off Zinj's fleet. Obviously the New Republic was planning some sort of an attack, hoping to open enough of a hole to send a fleet through. And it had to be a fleet, something more important than a mere spy ship, for anyone to have spent so much money ensuring that the ships got through the corridor safely. Reason could feel it in his bones, something big was coming. So he had calculated the vectors, gauging possible military targets, had narrowed his list to 6, ranking them by possibility. So much territory to cover, and so much uncertainty. Reason pondered the possible targets one last time, and looked beyond the obvious possibilities. There, far off on his charts, was Dathomir, and Reason studied the planet, felt an odd tingling in his bones. Dathomir was already well protected, so far within Zinj's territory that the New Republic could not possibly know of the warlord's operations there. The shipyards? Could the New Republic be planning to attack the shipyards? No, that didn't feel right. They wanted something on the planet. Such a rugged, dangerous place. There were a number of prisoners on the planet that the New Republic might want, if the New Republic even knew of the penal colony, but no one would be stupid enough to try to land there. Reason had met the natives, and the very notion of landing on Dathomir sent a chill creeping down his spine. Still, the planet seemed to beckon to Reason. Here, here. They are coming here. Once, when Reason was in his early teens, he'd watched a military parade on Coruscant with his father, and during the parade, Darth Vader, Dark Lord of the Sith, had stalked by, nearly. Instead, Lord Vader had halted the parade, stopped to look at Reason, pat him on the head. Reason remembered how his frightened image had been reflected in the Dark Lord's helmet, remembered the cold terror as that armored hand patted his head, but Vader had only said softly, "As you serve the Empire, trust your sensitivity," and then he moved on. Hesitantly, Reason suggested reinforcements for Dathomir, despite his belief that the New Republic would not attack, then keyed in the sequence on his computer terminal that would send the encrypted warning to Zinj. The warlord was a thorough man. Zinj would take care of it. Chapter 8. Leia awoke to darkness. She had been lying still for a long time, staring up into blackness, unmoving. She had been concentrating on being still, concentrating so hard that her head ached and her muscles cramped. Han's last words had been, "Lie still and be quiet," and with all her might she had struggled to comply. With the sudden realization of that betrayal, she screamed, "Han," and tried to sit up. Her head hit something hard, and she had to lie back down. She felt a grate beneath her, and the familiar, subdued rumble of the Millennium Falcon's hyperdrive engines. It had been 5 years since she'd last hidden in the Falcon's smuggling compartment, and it still smelled the same. "Han Solo, I'm going to kill you," she thought. "No, on second thought, you'll be lucky if you only die." She felt in the dark around her for the latch, found it, and tried to pull it back. It wouldn't open. She fingered it, and found that it was broken. She rolled over, found something small and metal, banged it against the roof. "Han Solo, you let me out of here this minute," she shouted, felt the thing in her hand vibrate and emit a hissing noise. Leia held it to her ear. "Oh great. An air exchanger. At least he didn't want me to suffocate." She shook it, and listened to the rattling of the air exchanger's busted innards. "All right, Solo. You let me out of here. This is no way to treat a princess." She banged on the ceiling of the compartment, kept banging, but got no response. As the air got warmer, Leia began to wonder if Han could even hear her. Was background noise drowning out her calls? She lay next to the Quadex power core, the main power source for the ship, and every few moments the piping above her head would hiss as coolant surged toward the core. The compartments weren't large, but they circled a third of the interior of the ship, from the entry ramp, over to the cockpit corridor, and around to the passenger bunk beds. Leia closed her eyes and considered. Han and Chewie normally bunked over by the technical station in the lounge. There was a wall separating her from the technical station, but Han should have heard her pounding if he were there. He might, however, still be in the cockpit, a good 7 or 8 meters away. If they were in the cockpit, and the bulkhead door was closed, there would be no way for Han or Chewie to hear her calls. And now her air was running out. Leia picked up the busted air exchanger, banged against the ceiling harder and harder, but resisted the impulse to yell for fear that her oxygen would run out all the faster. After only a few minutes, her arms burned with fatigue, and Leia stopped to rest. She felt like crying. Han knew she didn't trust this faulty metallic mélange, gleaned from forgotten junkyards and cut-rate dealers. Sure, the Falcon was fast and well-armed, but it was also always falling apart. Han had 3 droid brains running all his jury-rigged, modified systems, and Leia felt sure that all his technical problems couldn't come by mere accident. Han said that the brains bickered, but those droid brains had to be sabotaging each other's systems. Someday, one of them would do something really bad, and the whole ship would blow. It was just a matter of time. She banged on the ceiling again. The hatch above her opened a crack. Chewbacca growled. "What do you mean the sound couldn't be coming from here?" 3PO said, his voice muffled by the hatch. "I'm sure I heard something banging right under here. Why you don't scrap this old bucket of space debris is far beyond me." The hatch flipped open, and Chewie and 3PO peered in. Chewie's eyes widened in surprise, and 3PO lurched back. Chewie howled, and 3PO said, "Princess Leia Organa, why are you hiding in there?"
"I've come to kill Han," Leia said, "and this is the only way I could sneak aboard the ship.
What do you think I'm doing in here, you turbo-powered dummy? Han kidnapped me."
"Oh dear."
3PO muttered, and he and Chewie looked at each other, then hurried to help her from the hold. Leia got up, feeling a bit dizzy, and Chewbacca looked off toward the cockpit. His eyes were hard, and the fur on the back of his neck had raised. He growled menacingly, and for one moment Leia thought that surely Chewie would rip off Han's arms in typical Wookiee fashion. Chewie stalked toward the cockpit, and Leia ran after him, saying, "Wait, wait." Han was sitting in the captain's chair, his fingers flying over the instrument panels. The wash of stars in the viewscreens was a brilliant white, signifying that they were hurtling through hyperspace at the Falcon's top speed of 0.6 above light speed. Chewie growled, and Han didn't turn to face them.
"So, did you figure out what that banging noise was?"
Han asked.
"You bet he did,"
Leia said. At her back, 3PO shouted, "I suggest you return the princess immediately, before we all wind up in the brig." Han turned calmly, swiveling in his chair, and put his hands behind his head.
"I'm afraid we can't return just yet. We're locked on course for Dathomir, and the helm won't respond to any other orders."
Chewbacca rushed forward to the co-pilot's seat, hit a sequence of keys, growled questioningly at Leia. 3PO translated, "Chewbacca wants to know if you would like him to beat Han for you." Leia looked at the Wookiee, and knew how much that question must have cost him. Chewbacca owed a life debt to Han, and was bound by his code of honor to protect Solo. But perhaps, under the extreme circumstances, the Wookiee felt Han needed a little correction. Han raised a hand in warning.
"You can beat me if you want, Chewie, and I doubt I could stop you. But before you knock me senseless, I want you to think about something. It takes two people to bring this ship out of hyperdrive, and you can't do it without me."
Chewie looked at Leia and shrugged.
"You think you're so smart," Leia said. "You think you have all the answers.
Chewie, keep him in here. He brought a Hapen gun of command aboard, and I'm going to shoot him with it."
Han pulled a gun from his holster, and Leia realized it wasn't his normal blaster. It was the Hapen gun, but Han had broken off the circuitry on the barrel.
"I'm sorry, Princess, I think it's busted."
He let it drop to the floor.
"All right, what is it you want from me?"
Leia asked, feeling somewhat defeated.
"7 days," Han said. "I want you to spend 7 days with me on Dathomir. I'm not even asking for equal time with Isildur, just a mere 7 days. After that, I'll take you straight back to Coruscant."
Leia folded her arms and tapped her foot nervously, looked at the floor, made herself stop tapping, then looked up at Han.
"What's the point?"
"The point is, Princess, that 5 months ago you told me you loved me, and it wasn't the first time.
You used to love me. You believed it, and you made me believe it.
I thought our love was something special, something I would gladly die for, and I'm not going to let you throw away our future just because some other prince comes along."
"Other prince," he'd said.
Leia tapped her foot, and had to consciously will herself to stop.
"Then you admit it? You are the king of Corellia?"
"I never said that."
Leia looked away at 3PO, glared back at Han.
"What if I don't love you anymore? What if I really have changed my mind?"
"The news nets are already reporting that I've abducted you," Han said. "They began broadcasting the story just before we bugged out. If you don't love me, then I'll bring you back in 7 days, and I'll serve my time in prison. But if you do love me," Han paused, "then I want you to kiss Isildur goodbye and marry me."
He jerked his thumb, pointing at his chest.
Leia found her head shaking in frustration.
"You've got a lot of nerve."
Han stared into her eyes.
"I've got nothing to lose."
He really was putting everything on the line, as he had done for her time and time again. A few years ago she had thought he was dashing and bold, perhaps a bit reckless. Now that she thought about it, he had only seemed reckless because he so often risked his life for her. Han would almost throw it away at her whim. What she had once deemed an almost inhuman courage was really a sign of his unflagging devotion. And Leia found her heart pounding in fear at the thought that someone could love her that much. "All right," Leia swallowed. "You have a deal." "Princess Leia," 3PO said in consternation. Leia added, "But I hope you like prison food." As soon as the Bith ship dropped out of hyperspace, near the maelstrom of rubble that circled the Roche system, Luke knew there was trouble. He couldn't feel Leia anywhere nearby. He went to his room, called the New Republic's ambassador to the Verpines over subspace radio, and got the old man out of bed. "What's so important?" the ambassador snapped. "What has happened to Princess Leia Organa?" Luke asked. "I was supposed to meet her here." The ambassador frowned. "She got kidnapped a couple of days ago, by General Solo. I watch the Holo vids when I can, but I'm a busy man. I don't have much time for such nonsense. You could always call Coruscant, if it's that important to you." Luke frowned. His status as a war hero didn't give him enough pull to make hyperspace calls on Holo vid. Besides, a call wouldn't get him any closer to Leia. He needed to go back to Coruscant, start from there. "Do you have any ideas where I might find Han and Leia?" The ambassador yawned, scratched his bald head. "Who do you think I am, the chief of espionage? Nobody knows where they are. Eyewitnesses claim to have sighted Solo on at least 100 worlds. Invariably it turns out to be only a rumor, or some lookalike gets nabbed. I'm sorry, son, I can't be any help." The ambassador flipped off the communicator, and Luke sat, puzzled. He seldom received such rude treatment from anyone, much less dignitaries. He guessed that the operator hadn't told the ambassador who was calling. Luke closed his eyes, and stretched with his senses. Sometimes, in his sleep he would dream about Leia. Usually, if she was within the same star system, Luke could feel her presence. She was nowhere nearby. He decided to get his fighter out of storage and head for Coruscant. Han was working in the galley aboard the Falcon, trying to put together his fourth candlelight dinner in as many days. The smell of spiced Eric tongue wafted up, and Han was busy spooning some pudding into Cora shells when the pudding bowl tipped over and dropped on the floor, spattering the walls and Han's pant leg. Chewbacca had been standing at the viewport, and the Wookiee turned and laughed. "Go ahead," Han said. "Laugh it up, fur brain. But let me tell you something. By the end of this trip, Leia is going to realize she loves me. In case you haven't noticed, it's only been 4 days, and she's already warming up to me nicely." Chewbacca growled disparagingly. "You're right," Han said with a tone of dejection, "Hoth will warm up before she will. And I suppose mating rituals are much simpler where you come from. When you love a woman, you probably just bite her on the neck and drag her to your tree. But we handle things differently where I come from. We make our women nice dinners, we compliment them, treat them like ladies." Chewie laughed derisively. "So we shoot them and drag them into our spaceships," Han admitted. "All right, so maybe I'm not that much more civilized than you, but I'm trying. I'm really trying." "Han, oh Han," Leia called from the lounge. "By any chance, do you have that first course ready? I am getting so hungry, and you know how irritable I get when I'm hungry." "Coming, princess," Han called sweetly as he opened the oven. He tried to pull out the pan of spiced Eric tongue with the bottom of his apron, burned his fingers. He yelped and stuck his hot fingers in his mouth, got a hot pad and dumped the tongue on a plate. Somehow, the tongue looked bluer than it should, and he wasn't sure if he had overcooked it, if the tongue was just bad, or if maybe he'd put in too much chew powder. "Are you about done in there?" Leia called. "Coming." Han shouted, and he brought the tongue to her. He'd set a nice red tablecloth over the hologram board, and the candelabra was all aglow. Leia looked spectacular in a dazzling white dress jumpsuit and pearls, the flames dancing in her dark eyes. He set the plate down, and said, "Dinner is served." Leia looked at him questioningly, raising an eyebrow.
"What?"
Han said.
"What is it this time?
Aren't you going to slice it for me?" she asked. Han looked at the vibroblade on the table. He'd seen Leia hack her way through a jungle with a dull machete. He'd seen her slice ropes off her hands with a piece of broken glass. He'd even seen her dispatch some kind of swamp monster with a pointed stick that wasn't anywhere near as sharp as that vibroblade.
"Of course I'll slice it for you," Han said.
"It would be my pleasure." He took the blade, and began slicing the tongue into portions. When he was halfway done, he decided he'd better check his progress.
"Are these slices all right for you? Would you like them thicker, thinner, sliced lengthwise instead of sideways?"
"The portions look fine," Leia said, and Han finished slicing the tongue, sat down to the table and picked up a napkin. Leia cleared her throat, looked up at him.
"What now, my pet?"
Han asked.
"Are you going to sit at this table with your dirty apron on?"
Leia asked.
"I mean, that is a little disgusting."
Han remembered a moment when they had shared stale rations in a battlefield on Mindar, dead stormtroopers all around.
"You're right," Han said.
"I'll take it off."
He got up, removed the apron, took it and hung it on a peg in the galley.
He came back and sat down. Leia cleared her throat.
"What now?"
Han asked.
"You forgot the wine," Leia said, looking at her glass.
Han glanced at her plate, and noticed that she'd already begun eating without him.
"Would you prefer white, red, green, or purple?"
"Red," Leia answered.
"Dry or wet?"
"Dry."
"Temperature?"
39 degrees.
"You aren't going to let me eat with you again tonight, are you?"
"No," Leia said firmly.
"I don't get it," Han said.
"It's been 4 days now, and outside of ordering me around, you haven't said one word to me.
I know you are mad at me.
You've got a right to be. Maybe I've ruined it for you, and you're never going to be able to like me. Or maybe you're getting so used to having servants around, that you just want to turn me into your slave. But I would hope, if nothing else comes out of this, that at the very least you would still like me as a friend."
"Maybe you're asking too much of me," Leia said.
"I'm asking too much of you,"
Han said.
"I'm the one who has been cooking and cleaning and taking care of your clothes and making your bed and flying this ship.
Just tell me this.
Just answer me this, and answer honestly. Isn't there anything you like about me anymore? Isn't there just one thing?
Something.
Anything."
Leia didn't answer.
"Maybe I should just turn the ship around," Han said.
"Maybe you should," Leia agreed.
"But I don't get it," Han said.
"You agreed to come on this trip," he shrugged, "albeit under duress, I'll grant you that.
But you're madder than you should be.
If you want to take it out on me, then go ahead.
I'm right here."
Han Solo, in the flesh.
He leaned his face forward.
"Go ahead, slap me.
Or kiss me.
Or talk to me."
"You're right," Leia said.
"You don't get it."
"Get what?"
Han said.
"Get what?
Give me a clue."
"All right,"
Leia said.
"I'll spell it out for you.
You, Han Solo the man, I can forgive. But when you brought me on this ship, you betrayed the New Republic that we serve.
You're not just Han Solo the man anymore.
You were Han Solo the hero of the Rebel Alliance, Han Solo the general of the New Republic.
And that Han Solo I can't forgive, I refuse to forgive.
Sometimes what you represent is so important that you can't let your standards down.
You become respected as an icon, as much for what you are as who you are."
"That's not my fault," Han said.
"I refuse to be bound by anyone's preconceived images of me."
"Fine," Leia said.
"Maybe you don't think the universe should work that way. maybe you want to be free to run off to be a pirate again or play around like a little boy, but that's not how the universe works. You're going to have to face up to that.
Fine, Han said, throwing his napkin on the table, so I'll face up to it.
After dinner.
You tell me what you want me to do, how you want me to act.
I'll change, forever.
I promise.
Okay.
Leia stared up at him, and something in her features softened.
Okay.
4 days later, the Millennium Falcon dropped out of hyperspace above Dathomir, and the proximity indicators screamed in warning. Leia came running, leaned over Han's pilot seat to look out. Star destroyers littered the sky, while shuttles and barges plotted up from a small red moon in a solid line toward a huge mass of metal piping and struts, 10 kilometers of gleaming scaffolding, that floated in space at an L5 point. It looked like some giant insect, but docked around it were thousands of craft, one super star destroyer, dozens of old Victory-class models and escort frigates, thousands of box-like barges. For one moment, Han stared at them in awe and then breathed angrily, "Trespassers."
Leia drew a deep breath.
"Well, Han, you've certainly struck the jackpot this time.
Why, this planet must have more enemy fighters than a hut has ticks."
Han glanced over at Chewie. The Wookiee was trying to pull up the nav charts for the Otega star system. On the head-up holo display, two red fighters began vectoring up from a star destroyer.
"Can the sarcasm, princess, and get yourself up to the gun well, we've got company."
Han nodded out the viewscreen to the TIE interceptors screaming toward them.
Leia knew enough not to ask if Han could outrun them.
He couldn't.
"Seriously, Leia, you better get up there," Han said.
"Once they get close enough to see that we're not an in-com Y4, they won't wait to shoot."
Leia ran up the corridor to the stairwell. Over the Falcon's radio, a controller began querying, "Incom Y4 Raptor, please identify yourself and your destination."
"Incom Raptor, please identify."
"Captain Brovar," Han answered, "carrying an inspection team for the planetary defense systems."
Han wiped the sweat from his forehead. This was the part he always hated, waiting to see if they'd swallow his story. After a delay of 4 seconds, Han knew the flight controller was querying his supervisor.
Always a bad sign.
The controller said after a moment, "This planet doesn't have a defense system."
Chewbacca glared at Han, and Han keyed the mic.
"I know. We're here to inspect the sites to install the planetary defense system."
The controller remained quiet too long, so Han added lamely, "We have an extra one, or parts of an extra one."
"I mean, you've got to store these defense systems somewhere, right?"
"Incom Y4 Raptor," a gravelly voice called over the same frequency.
"Do you have some kind of strange modifications to your ship?"
The interceptors were coming into visual range and Han couldn't rely on stealth anymore. He reached up to switch on the signal jammers, and Chewie winced.
"It's all right," Han promised.
"We won't fry our own circuitry this time.
I tested it before we left."
Han flipped the switch and prayed.
Chewbacca roared in fright, and Han glanced over, the nav computer had gone down.
As Han watched, the run lights for the hyperdrive motivator died, along with the rear targeting computer.
Han realized belatedly that he hadn't tested the jammers with the nav computer working.
They wouldn't be jumping to hyperspace anytime soon.
Chewie growled in terror, and Han dipped toward the glittering shipyard, diving toward a quad escort frigate.
All that metal would have to play hell with the sensors, and even though the TIE interceptors were technically faster and more maneuverable than the Falcon, Han would match his flying skills against these Academy jocks any day.
Bolts of blue blaster fire ripped across the Falcon's prow, bounced off the hull, and Leia shouted over her radio, "They're in range."
3PO stood behind the pilot seat watching the blaster fire, shouting and ducking with every near miss.
Han heard the welcome sound of the quad cannons as Leia returned fire.
The Falcon screamed toward the scaffolding and the frigate beyond.
Huge beams of plasteel flashed past, and Han flipped the Falcon sideways to slip through the scaffolding.
Han locked his forward targeting computer onto the frigate's primary sensor array. Without active shielding on, the huge frigate was just another hunk of space debris, and Han's first blast enveloped the sensor array in blue lightning. He fired his proton torpedoes in rapid succession, and they flashed in a brilliant ball that would have fried Han's eyes if he hadn't looked away. Among the brightening mushroom clouds, Han reversed thrusters, fired two concussion missiles into the thin stem of the frigate, the walkways that joined the frigate's monstrous engines with its forward arsenal. As the slowing Falcon dove for the breach in the frigate's hull, chunks of shrapnel burst against the forward concussion shielding. Chewie roared and shielded his face with his hands. The Falcon slammed into the yawning hold of the frigate, and warning sirens screamed. The control panels darkened as the concussion shielding overloaded, brightened again as it died. Smoke was rising from Chewie's panel, and he growled. "Quiet," Han hissed, putting his hand over Chewie's mouth. Both of the TIE interceptors screamed into the frigate and exploded. The corridor that the Falcon had crashed into filled with light and fire. "That's the problem with those transparent steel windows on the TIE fighters," Han thought. "The worthless things darken when they detect a blast, and then you can't see anything for the next 2 seconds." He'd counted on it. Han flipped off his radio jamming, began shutting down the Falcon. Leia came running down the corridor. "What in the hell do you think you're doing? You almost got us killed."
"Listen," Han said, raising a hand for quiet.
Between the concussion of the torpedoes and the fighters, and a few well-placed ion blasts, the frigate's orbit was already destabilizing. The ship was peeling away from the docks, as Dathomir's gravity well sucked it down.
"Oh, great," Leia said.
"I'm supposed to be happy that we're going to crash into the planet instead of blow up in space."
"No," Han said.
"Our concussion shielding should have kept us from damaging the Falcon too badly, and now that our sensor jamming is off, Chewie should be able to get the nav computer back online. Meanwhile, Zinja's navy thinks we all crashed, and as the frigate drops toward the planet, we'll quietly move out of their interception range for 10 minutes or so, plenty of time for us to plot a course. Then we just casually ease our way out of here and head for home.
Trust me, I've done this before."
Han took a deep breath and prayed.
"Go ahead, Chewie, turn the nav computer back on.
Show her." Chewie growled, shot Han a nasty look and flipped the switch. The monitor stayed dim. Chewie frantically began testing other switches. The hyperdrive motivator stayed off, as did the rear deflector shields. 3PO had been watching behind the pilot's seat and he began gesticulating wildly but refrained from speaking. When he saw that the motivators wouldn't go on, he shouted, "We're doomed." Han jumped out of his seat.
It's okay, nobody panic. We just have a little fried circuitry here.
I'll fix it." He shoved his way past 3PO and ran down the corridor to the engineering station and pulled off a faceplate to get to the motivator circuitry. The nav computer he could sort of live without, for 10 minutes. Just make a quick jump to get out of the solar system, then take a few days to try to fix it nice and leisurely in the cold of space. But the motivators, he needed those now. He pulled off his vest, wrapped it around his fist, jerked back the faceplate. Fire erupted from the charred slag in the circuit box, and Leia appeared behind him with a fire extinguisher. She began spraying the circuitry and Han stepped back, seeing that it was useless.
It's okay," he muttered and ran back to the cockpit, fired all his circuits and let the diagnostics computer begin a readout.
The forward sensor arrays had been smashed during the crash.
"That's okay, I don't need sensors as long as I can see where I'm going," he groaned.
Concussion shielding gone. Top radio dishes clipped off. Most of the rest of it looked pretty good. As long as the diagnostics were correct, they could fly out of here, as long as they could break free of the wreck and no one shot at them and no one caught them and they didn't try to make it off planet.
Han's head began to whirl, and he realized that the frigate must be spinning as it sank toward Dathomir.
"Hang on, folks, it's going to be a rough ride down," he muttered. He glanced back at Leia, saw that she wasn't mad, wasn't berating him. Instead, her pale face was set in fear, and her eyes seemed dilated. The hair on her scalp had raised. Han had never seen her so scared.
What?
What? He asked, glancing frantically at the diagnostics display.
I feel something down there, Leia said, on the planet.
Something.
What?
Han asked.
Leia closed her eyes. She didn't have Luke's sensitivity yet. But Han knew she had the potential.
I see, drops of blood on a white tablecloth.
No, more like sunspots, black against the brilliance.
Only, the black spots are filthier than that.
Loathsome.
Leia frowned in concentration, inhaled, sucking deep breaths, her lower lip trembling.
Leia's eyes blinked open, and her face was pale again, stark with terror.
Oh Han, we can't go down there.
End of part 1. This book will be released in segments each week on our YouTube channel, free of charge. However, to help support the costs involved in creating this audiobook, the entire book is available now to our Patreon supporters. If you would like to listen to this entire book early, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and may the Force be with you, always.